we have this chance to change the name now and just kind of do what we want because that wasn't working, and change the name on the way to the Mint 400 one year in 2014. And we're just like, it was just like, this is our last chance. We're only going to do stuff we want to do is like motorcycle stuff, like Harley stunt stuff. When it was a lot of off-road racing, and kind of went through a list of names, and Heatwave stood out.
So how the hell does this happen? And I saw it and I was like, oh, that's cool that y'all did, like, you know, a livery. And then I started looking, I was like, oh. And then I had to do digging. I spent probably 30 minutes of going back through and I'm like, that's the fucking car. How the do these dudes out there get this?
Yes.
If you were going to start another business tomorrow, are you going to start that in 2001? Or are you going to start that in like current times? You've got all the access to social media, or you have no access to social media and very limited internet.
Even like RoboCop, those Tauruses, those were sick. Yeah. You know, yeah. Like, I'm like,
RoboCop was good.
Anybody that has a driver's license,
shouldn't be
scooting. Yeah,
like, I mean, there's, you shouldn't. There's a...
Welcome everybody back to another edition, another episode, another show, if you will. Oil and Whiskey. This week in studio, some of the best ones, always in studio. Heatwave Visual CEO, founder, co-founder.
Yeah.
That's all that.
Just the owner.
Head dude.
Just
wears a ton of hats. Yeah.
Justin Herter.
Yeah.
Justin
Hertel.
Hertel.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's the part we cut out.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And we
you
put
said
in
it right the first time.
Yeah. Yeah, so
right.
Justin Hertel. Yeah. Exactly. Everybody heard it.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Fuck. It's okay. We're still meeting each other.
Here. Yeah.
we're feeling each other out, right?
Yeah.
Man, super excited that you could come out here. I know that we've been a fan of the brand for a while.
Yeah, thanks.
I started following you on Instagram, all of the channels, probably right before COVID, and just consuming all the videos. I mean, the long format, the short format stuff, and it was just like, I just want to hang out with these guys. Yeah, they're fucking cool.
That's the only reason we did this podcast. Yeah. But this dude's pretty fucking cool.
I bet you
we just want to hang out with him.
Yeah.
Let's get him out here, give him some whiskey, and see what he'll say.
Yeah, Josh, you were like the early, you found that early on. Josh was fanboying out on it. He's like, dude, really? You got to see this Heatwave visual stuff. This guy's fucking awesome. He's got like all these bitching cars and they do this rad shit. Like, check him out.
No, serious business though. Like, we're very cognizant of branding and what, you know, the outside, what your customers view you as. And it's difficult to carry yourself in a way that you're personable, fun, and but still like a corporation. Like there's a difference between like, hey guys, it's a couple of guys in the garage, you know, and we like building these little products and selling them, and you can just talk to us anytime. And then the corporation that, you know, has no face and stuff. And there's a happy medium. And that's difficult.
Yeah, you have to blend it. And for us, I think, and for me, it's just always be authentic and, you know, had success being myself. And so, yeah, it just rings through everything that we do. You know, it's just stuff that we're actually into, you know, like, so yeah, everything you see is like, it's real. Like there's nothing fake, but it's also, there's nothing like super ridiculous cause nothing's fake, but it's also just try and have fun with everything and build the brand around that. But you still have to balance it. There is the corporate side of it, things. And then there's also, you know, connecting with the customers and being shoulder to shoulder with them, being someone that they can relate to, because we don't want to put ourselves like in this place where it's, you're just, they can't relate to it, you know, because you can't do that. I mean, we just wouldn't be able to portray that in an authentic way. Again, it comes back to being authentic. So that's kind of what you're seeing is actually what it's like.
Is that like an actual mission or forethought when you went into it, or did it just evolve and you're like, this is working, let's keep riding it?
In the beginning, no. Like this whole thing was, we got into the, like the affordable sunglass space in 2012 and tried to attack a market that wasn't ours, you know, like trying to kind of just build a brand. And it was party shades at first. And I don't know how far back you want to go, but yeah, we thought, yeah, attack the college market and, you know, maybe get some, you know, college team licensing and get in and just sell as many as we could for $20 a pair. And we were doing like any event that we could. We were doing like music festivals and things of that nature. And I just saw like the future. There's these people setting up there, and it was like folding tables, like these leathery people that have been, their whole gig was going to music festivals that were like brew fests and things of that nature.
You
and
saw what your future could be.
So tired. And I was like, this is it. Like this sucks. Like I do not want to be coming to these things. It was so tiring because your party shades, you got to be party shades. And it's exhausting, you know? So, and then also the brand just wasn't, we would sell on the weekends and come back and wouldn't sell anything during the week. Like no one was coming back to the website, no matter how good people said the stuff was at the events, like no one was coming through. And like the music festival and the beer fest stuff, like people complain about the prices, but they're spending $20 on a beer and they can't spend $20 on glasses until they start to get faded. And then they start to come around and then they won't leave you alone. So it was extremely exhausting. And we just hit this point where it was like, we can change the name now. And we knew the logos and good, all the artwork and stuff was good. Everything was good. It's like, we have this chance to change the name now and just kind of do what we want, because that wasn't working. And kind of went through a list of names, and Heatwave stood out and changed the name on the way to the Mint 400 one year in 2014. And we're just like, it was just like, this is our last chance. We're only going to do stuff we want to do, is like motorcycle stuff, like Harley stunt stuff. It was a lot of off-road racing and just kind of focusing on the communities that were kind of okay with us and we were okay with going to. I mean, we love that stuff. So, and then after that, it was just only do what we want to do, only do what we were into.
What were you doing before y'all decided to get into the affordable eyewear space?
Okay,
because that's an interest. That's
yeah.
How do you, like, you're sitting around having beers and you're like, you know,
a
what
chain of events that happens?
Yeah, so it's like, it's kind of like everything. I don't know how far back we really want to go.
We got all the time in the world. This is about.
You came all the way out here. So yeah. Let's go way back.
So I guess it would start as like, I'm a second generation business person, however you want to say it. I don't.
But you're a man, and you're in business.
Yeah, businessman. Yeah, my dad was he came out from the Midwest to California, and he was doing computers back in the days. He was a big skier, so he started doing ski wax, and so I kind of just grew up in Northern California with my dad. He did his own business, and we went skiing and stuff all the time, and got into snowboarding, and his company burnt down in 89, but he still stayed on it. And I just kind of like learned by watching him, you know, and just that was all that I knew. And he was into computers, so got into computers at an early age and graphic design and things of that nature. And I was really into in the early 90s, like rollerblading was huge.
It's aggressive inline skating.
Yes, there we go. You know.
You want to be labeled the wrong way.
Yeah.
Let's just say we're all, I think, probably about the same age. This is a safe space. We can talk about like back or inline thrashing.
Yeah. Because like there was a point in time where it was way bigger than skateboarding, and I was in the second grade. You know, it's like, what are the kids in third grade doing? And they were all rollerblading. You know, no one was skateboarding. So, got into that and just stayed with that. And my dad had an extra, like, you know, 400 square foot spot in front of his wax company. And he was kind of trying to figure things out after the company burned down, and saw that I had a ton of friends that skated. And there was this shop in town that was just killing it, selling millions of dollars of skates. They had so many skates. They had containers out back just filled with them, you know? So he's like, okay, my son does this. He has about 25, 30 friends that do it. It's like, okay, we starts this shop. And then in the early .com stuff, starts this aggressivemall.com thing. And so I was loving life, you know, I was like skating all the time. My dad owned a skate shop, and
it's cool.
Couldn't get any better than that.
Yeah, it was awesome. And then go through high school and kind of do the high school thing, like get out of skating a little bit. I was like super, super into it before that though. And then he kind of kept going with it, but he brought in snowboarding and skateboarding and like scootering and stuff as that was kind of popular. And I was kind of riding motocross at the time too. I got into that and like when I was 16, and wasn't doing that much skating anymore. And then went to work for a local like lumber company and right out of high school and just wasn't, I think I got fired from there. We were like trying to, I definitely got fired. But we were trying to improve it. It was so old world that they didn't like that these kids were trying to like improve their yard. So I worked there with a couple of friends, got fired, went back to work for my dad by default, who was kind of hanging on to this shop by the thread. Cause he's in his 60s or something at that point. And he didn't know what he was doing, you know, like he was just kind of ordering
to sell the cool kids.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And he was kind of like, it wasn't the cool shop. So he couldn't get an open with the cool brands. So we had like the second and third tier snowboard brands and skateboard brands, like none of the cool shoe brands. Like, so skateboarding and that was not working out for that shop. It was basically like if someone rolled through and had no idea, and he'd make money like on snowboard rentals and hoping that they would screw the snowboard up so he could charge them for gouging the board, even though he would just rent it out next week.
Take it back and carve it up.
Yeah. So we're going real deep here. And when that skate shop was going, that's when I met my co-founder and my dad had hired him because he was just a local neighborhood kid. And I was working there and we kind of hung out, and this was kind of in the end of high school. But so that's when I first met him. Anyways, go back into it after getting fired after high school from this lumber company. And I'm like, start looking at all the rollerblade stuff that's going on still. And I'm like, I can do a better job than this. What everyone else was doing, like all the other shops. And I was like heavily into customizing stuff. And I was just willing to put the effort in. And I had done website work and learned the graphic design stuff since my dad was into computers, like was already kind of doing that stuff. I was into photography and could make skate videos and stuff like that. I was like, so I was just able to kind of go in and I was like, in the world of the internet, you could just make yourself look like this huge company, but we were still operating out of like a sub 1,000 square foot, like old, like mechanic shop that was like, we were renting a spot from like a Maytag, like inside of a Maytag.
What year is that?
This had to be around 2001. Okay. At this point.
So internet's kind of rocking and rolling. Yeah. But you had the fire icon and things right at 2001. You could put on the website, you know, that.
The animated GIFs. Yeah. Just to fill it in with garbage. You had to slow it down and the construction GIF with the guy going, like, coming soon. Try not to get too far off the timeline here. I just started focusing on that. And within a couple of years, went from this 700 square foot shop to a 5,000 square foot warehouse. I think by 2003, we were in a 5,000 square foot warehouse. So basically, through my authenticity, like I was again super into skating again. Like I refound, like it had progressed so much in this point where I kind of took a break that it like reignited the fire. And I was like, even though that industry was like coming straight down, like we were still going up. Cause we had nothing to go from. So we went from a couple $100,000 a year, like barely holding on, which is like, was big in back then, but then went to, I think it was a couple $1 million a year, which was just crazy. I mean, in the early 2000s and my dad was like, oh my God. Like at first he was like, you can't do this. Well, he was like, why are you ordering all these skates? Like, is this stuff paid for? Like, he operated a very old world business and he had like no return policy. Like, and I just started changing all of that. I'm like, cause I had bought from Summit. I was into cars and stuff before this. Yeah. And then I was like, you can return anything. Like any of these places, like get it. You don't like it. You can return it. Like, and you get 100% of your money back unless you install the headers and scratch them. But even then you could probably argue with them and like give you your money back. And they give you like a return tag and everything. Like, he's like, you can't do that. I'm like, okay. And I just did it anyways. Like, and then he started to just, okay, I can just take a step back. Like, and there was some risk there for him, but I was growing the business, so he couldn't really say a whole lot. So it grew and got it up to maybe around like 13, 14 employees. And this is like an industry with like an incredibly low, like glass ceiling, you know, like And it just kind of hit this point. I mean, it was great. I think in 2009, 2010, I thought I was going to be doing that forever. And then within a year, I just saw things start to really turn around. Like, we started to get super limited on what we could do. And the bar had, we had just continued to raise the bar. We had done things that nobody had done in that space, like collaborating with other brands. Like, we had designed pretty much everything under that skate shop. It wasn't just a skate shop. We were doing, like an entire like apparel line under that, accessories. Like, I had done another company doing skate liners. So I had experience of getting stuff manufactured overseas and dealing with that. Just totally had nothing to lose. So it was just risking it, working with all these overseas people, and kind of found some magic vendors that, you know, usually kind of get screwed, but the stuff was like quality and just working with, we just kind of figured it out all on our own. Go ahead.
You'd be pretty young at that. Like, yeah. How old are you?
I'm 42. Okay. So it was 19, early 20? 20s. Early 20s. Kind of.
That's just some serious shit to be just, doing. Just kind of going age. After I mean, it. Reaching out and finding overseas vendors and collabing. I mean.
Yeah. And we were working with all the biggest skate manufacturers and everything. And they just really dug what we were doing. I think we showed that we were elevating everything for everybody at that point. And we had like a killer team, and we were going out just trying to kind of raise the bar to get people to expect more, and just kind of trying to build it up. And I was like friends with like, excuse me, I had to take a sip.
No, get after it.
That's part of the program.
Yeah.
I'm like, you guys have all drank. I haven't drank anything yet. And being in Northern California was like, we had a really good scene there too, and work with a lot of great people who are awesome creatives and video and photo. And so kind of, you know, it wasn't about just the skating. It was about making videos and stuff like that. So cut my teeth doing that and work with the manufacturers and kind of learn the process a little bit there. And, and then had a shop to sell it out of, like the most popular shop. And again, this is small numbers compared to anything now, but it was awesome then. We could
pretty damn good.
Yeah.
When it starts going downhill, it's not a slow fade. It's fast.
It was a lot of people didn't realize it in the industry, but I saw it. Like, again, seeing this on the earlier story of seeing the person setting up this folding table that was double my age, and that was what they were doing. I saw what kind of where things were headed with there was no new blood in the sport, like younger kids. I mean, it was all a lot of older guys. And
are you seeing it from the manufacturer side too, as far as new stuff not coming out and that stuff starting to contract?
I was seeing a shortage of supply. So we were not in control of our own supply for our best selling products. So, and them telling us, oh, this shortage of this will never happen again. And then it happens again the next year. And you know, that's cutting into your bottom line. You know, it's like the stuff that we can sell, we can't even get. And then there's no younger kids skating anymore. Very few. Like, they're trying to market to the older guys, and they're trying to figure out what to do. But, and the other action sports had just gapped blading, like, and just pushed it aside. They tried to suppress it. Which I get, but they never saw scootering like on the other. They had their finger in the dike to like stop this leak of like people becoming like rollerbladers, but then scootering came over the levee, you know, like, and kind of took over. Like, so it didn't matter. There was always going to be something there that was going to take it over. But
was
like,
scootering a thing? Like,
it's a thing now.
Well, it's a huge thing now. My son's like a competitive skateboarder. So we travel all over. We're at all sorts of skate parks. So you've got like the scooter kids, you know?
Yeah.
And those little fuckers, I mean, when you get like the kids who just really can't, they're out there just like having fun. Right. Or there's dudes who like have beards with gray hair in them doing flips and shit. Yeah. And I'm like, anybody that has a driver's license,
shouldn't be on
a scooter. Yeah.
Like, I mean, you just shouldn't.
There's a lot to that, you know, like it, but they take it very seriously. It was no different than rollerblading, you know, like these guys have known it since they were in grade school, and they're out there jumping these huge stairs, and they're sponsored, and they take it very seriously. So it's really no different.
It's a wild sport. I mean, it's funny because I spend a lot of time at skate parks and stuff now. So I always, anytime I see like a dude on rollerblades, I'm always like taking my phone out, like video, because it looks like honestly, it looks kind of ridiculous, like, now. But that was me. Today. I mean, shit, when I was 12, 13, I'm in there, I'm, like, you know, doing, like, late 180s off there of, like, stair sets, you know?
And yeah,
like,
it's like...
We're going to Salvation Army to get the biggest jeans you can find. Yeah,
absolutely. All the big jeans are coming back now. All that stuff's coming back. Yeah, dude, I don't know.
Fucking shifty Royales.
There we go. You know exactly.
Yeah, I know the scene.
You're pretty hardcore. You were into it.
Yeah, we were into it big time.
All right, thoughts on filing your... Was it trucks on those or... File in the middle of the road blades down so you can grind.
Oh, no, no. You got to go get your grooves.
Yeah, of course. Grind plates. Yeah. We hit it early on where they didn't have, like, you couldn't get grind plates in the little, I don't even remember what they called, the little wheels.
Yeah, the anti-rockers.
C-notes.
Yeah, right. There you go.
The little Senate C-notes.
Yeah. There you go.
But we had, like,
so out of my element.
He's like, he's going to walk away now.
We had it, like, pre-aggressive in line where you'd take, like, the speed roller blades and we'd just take out the middle wheels and then we'd, like, barrel sand, like, little groove.
Yeah.
And we're making our own wax in the garage and, like, just... soul sliding things and grinding things. You didn't even have a soul on it, but then it took off like crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you had the Boutangs, the C-Notes.
Yeah, you guys know that Senate catalog. Yeah.
The backward Superman song.
Yeah. I mean, that's when it was like big time. It like took off, you know, I think it took the world by storm. And that's like part of the reason the X Games got started. That was one of the premier things at those first extreme games when it was extreme games. Yeah, then it just kind of fizzled out.
It was like overnight. Like it was aggressive inlining thing. It's all over the X Games. Nobody knew what rollerblades were the next day.
Yeah.
It's like gone. At least in our world.
Where we were sitting. Yeah, that's the way it went.
It was gone. The hotter that stuff burns, usually the faster it burns out. You know, like skateboarding and stuff had been there for a long time. It's, you know, more technical. Like rollerblading is cool, but it takes like that real good guy to make it look good. Like a lot of the guys you see at the skate parks now, you're kind of like, oh yeah. And it's like, it's really easy to make it look bad. Like, but there's some guys out there that just are phenomenal. It can absolutely kill it. Like it's getting more technical, like, cause I still pay attention to it. I can't do it anymore. But it's, there's always going to be that thing there for it. I did it forever. And then, and I think that was another thing for me. Like I had gotten like this weird like ankle injury where I couldn't skate anymore. And so I kind of got a little jaded because I couldn't skate. So I'm in this industry where I can't participate in it anymore. And I gave myself like these breaks and would like, okay, I'd stop for a month. And I'd say, okay, that didn't work. Stop for 3 months. And basically went to like a stop for a whole year and then tried it again. And then just immediately hurt my ankle again. And then I heard I could get this surgery, but I'd had like a shoulder surgery and it just messed it up forever. I'm like, I can still run. I can jump. I can still snowboard, which I've done for longer than I've rollerbladed. So I was like, I can do all that. No problem. I'm not getting surgery for skating. I was like, I had such a good career. Like I had a great time doing it. I was like, it's
time to hang up.
Skates. Can't do it forever.
Hang them up.
And so I think that part of it kind of too was getting to me. I'm like in this industry where it was me. But it like created this, you know, it showed me like all this creativity and all this, you know, how to like spot hunt and how to make do with nothing, you know, make a spot out of something, you know, and like, and all the creative people that we skated with or that I skated with was just such a great experience. And there's still so many people there that are extremely creative. And then the experience through that skate shop, like that's how I cut my teeth. And that's how we'd actually done. Getting back into the business side of things, we had done sunglasses as one of the accessories for the skates because we were under this manufacturer advertised price policy thing where you can't ever keeps the playing field. It's kind of like price fixing, but a lot of these like
that's MAP pricing. Yeah, it's MAP not price fixing. It's completely
it's to legal. Keep it fair because you get these guys, they open them up and they just start. They have no overhead and then the mom and pop shops can't compete with that when they're selling their stuff out of a closet on eBay. So MAP, like, but we had to adhere to that, but how do you incentivize it? So it's like, okay, we're giving away our skate wax with it. We're giving away these sunglasses all of a sudden and other things, you know? So you, so that I saw how people reacted to the sunglasses and it kind of went, we only were giving them away with the skates. And then we were like, okay, let's try and sell them. And they were $5. And it's just like, and then they would sell out immediately. And was like, okay. And went from there. There were those cheapy promo, like, Ray-Ban looking glasses with the neon arms, and you just print on one side of them.
Cellophane package.
Crap. It's total crap. You know, like the tire companies give them away and stuff now. Like, they're just on a table. I was like, okay, let's actually get a mold made. I was kind of, like, pressured into it. But it went from a $5 sunglass to something that was, like, $15. So you're, like, 3Xing the price. It's like, all right, let's try. And we're going from spending, like, $500 on them to then spending, I think it was probably close to, like, $18,000 for that first order of them. Is like, all right, let's try. And people loved them. I was like, okay, like, and this is when I still thought the skate shop thing was going to do well. We just had this pair of glasses under the line, and we were selling them and giving them away, you know. And then when I saw that kind of cloud coming and this thing wasn't going to last forever, I was like, okay, what do we got that we can kind of spin off? And we were doing some backpacks and stuff, tried to maintain that. And then the sunglass thing. And that's when my partner at the time came. He had hit me up on Instant Messenger when that was still a thing. It was like, he was living in New York, super creative, smart guy. He's like, hey, I'm coming back from New York. He was working at an advertising agency. I'm coming back. Like, you still, we kind of kicked back like, oh, you want to do the sunglass thing? Oh yeah. Cause he was there when we did the sunglasses, the other sunglasses for the skate shop. He's like, hey, you still, and we were like, oh, well, let's start a sunglass company. Like, ha ha ha. Like, well, like, let's, oh yeah, sure. Like, if I have time for that. Cause, anyways, and it, he's like, you still want to do that? I'm like, yeah, let's seriously do it. So I had, he came back, and I think we started on it right away, February, 2012. And I think we had sunglasses that September, and that's when we did like our first event, and then the rest is kind of history. You know, it's like it didn't take off right away. I mean, we still had 5 years. Like, it's like, oh yeah, we did this before. People love these. Like, this is gonna be easy. Like, it's no problem. Like, yeah. it was a grind. It was an absolute grind for 5 years, even having all the experience. But I didn't use any of the previous customer base from the skate shop, even though the two were overlapped. Like, they were in the same building for several years. Like, I had my right hand man now running the skate shop while I focused on the sunglass stuff to get that going, to give that the time it needed to get going. But I was like, if I can't get this going on its own, then it's, and we just have to rely on the skate shop customers, we're not going to have a leg to stand on. So
what was some of the biggest challenges early on the product side? I'm not worried about really like the sales, the marketing, you know, and stuff like that. Those are all, you know, kind of standard challenges. And I'm sure there's stories, but from the product side of things, was it keeping up with changing trends? Was it giving the customers too many options? Was it trying to like identify the next style or having too many styles? What was some of the challenges there?
I think inexperience in the market was huge. We had such a small like sample size with what we were dealing with before, and since we could give a ton of the stuff away and it was still considered a success in the other company, in the new company it didn't work. And then just kind of going off what caught our eyes, you know. So we made a huge mistake in ordering all these wild colors and too high quantities in the custom arms, and then the manufacturer that we had chosen, who was good to us before with the skate shop, had on our biggest order, I think it took, because we didn't have that much money saved up. I think the initial order probably took like $60,000, which was no small sum.
Right.
Then, you know, it was, and they just screwed everything up. You know, like we had a major problem with how they imported this stuff. They left documents out. We had a huge problem with the FDA, and so we had to send everything back once it got here. You know, we kind of got a little momentum and then had to send everything back, and then that was like a black eye for the manufacturer to get the goods rejected in China. So then when we had to had to get them to fix this stuff, they were like no longer willing to work with us. They ended up like just totally screwing us over. And then we come to like learn later on, like, oh, people from that part of China, like they'll do you dirty. Like, we're just like, okay, great. Like, Let's try and get out of this what we can. And during that transition, I think, I don't know, was that when we had all this custom packaging and everything made. So we invested way too much time and all the cool, like, stuff that no one was ever going to see if they were never going to get the product in their hands. So we spent a lot of time focusing on stuff that we thought people were going to see and nobody ever saw it. And the bright colors, like black sells 10 to 1 over the colors. So we just didn't know that, you know, like you kind of get, our sales rep now is like, you got to have the sizzle to sell the steak. And so it's like, we know we kind of need some of the crazy stuff to bring some eyes to it. And it's like kind of,
and it's a little too wild and they go to the more.
Yeah. Then they'll be like, oh yeah, but I won't wear that every day. I'll get the black. So it's like,
but it's a crazy period of time like that in 2012, 2013 to be doing that. Like, you know, back then nobody was in like the 80s, 90s stuff. I feel like just came like a tidal wave recently. I mean, it's still rocking and rolling,
but
to be doing stuff back then.
Yeah.
I don't think a lot of people saw that that was a trend.
Yeah. I think cause it's just kind of where we grew up. And kind of where my mind was, I was just like, yeah, this stuff's going to hit. We were doing the bright colors. We hadn't brought the single like shield lens style stuff in yet. But yeah, it was like, we were rocking all these like vintage, like NASCAR hats and stuff at that time. And the NASCAR
you were doing
shirts.
That then?
Yeah. Like I was into that stuff then. And so it's like,
it wasn't even vintage then. That was just like a couple years old.
I got a box of like 90 hats for like $40, like, and they were like mint condition, like Budweiser, like King of Beer hats, like all these vintage like powerboat hats and all the NASCAR hats. And like now I see those things selling for like $60 for like for like the vintage stuff, like Miller MGD, like racing, Miller High Life racing, like all that stuff.
So you were doing that shit back then.
Yeah, like all the Good Ranch hats, we had all that stuff then, you know. So it's like, yeah, we just kind of been doing that, and we're doing kind of the race style stuff as soon as Heatwave kicked off, like all the logos and stuff repeating and all the sleeve prints and stuff. We were doing that then. So it was, but yeah, like in the, when we did this sunglass company, there was one brand at the time who was selling like affordable, like branded stuff, Knockaround. I don't know if you ever heard of them, and they were like, they were killing it. and then we started around the same time as Blenders Eyewear and, Pit Viper started. So it kind of all came about the same time. There was nobody really in that, in the branded space. Everyone was, they're a little bit higher, you know. Everything was $100, $150, like for the brands you're more familiar with, like Spy Electric, like Von Zipper. And there was all, they had like a wholesale network. You had to buy those through store, you know, like, and we were
Luxottica
just
was putting them out of business or buying them up along the way, right?
Luxottica was buying, they're more strategic. I think a lot of those brands I just mentioned are still independent. I believe Spy was public for a little bit, but I believe it got bought back, which was crazy. At the time we started, they were that was a publicly traded company.
That was a bit, I had several pairs of Spy.
Spy was a bitching brand back in the day. When I was like, was in sick. My inline days, I had like the wraparound green ones.
There you go.
That was cool. Shit. Yeah. And then something they like kind of disappeared.
Had to have the goggles. The
people told you were cool. People stopped you and said,
almost everybody I saw would just stop me on the street. I'd just be walking.
Yeah.
And they'd be like, dude, fucking keep it up. Like, well, you look badass.
A lot of that success, I think, was driven off of the X Games and the action sports. They were on all the freestyle moto guys. They were they were huge in supercross and motocross. Like all those brands are really prevalent there, and you know, so they were, and that was the space to be. That's where everyone was selling everything.
Oh, if Kerry Hart was wearing it, I was wearing it.
There you go. So
that's great. I think like the issue that I'm seeing, which is it's showing like how disconnected we are. You know, we talk a little bit of shit about like, you know, Michigan being like way behind us. Like you go to Central Michigan, and it's like you know you're going back like what do you think the 5, 6 years, 7 years maybe.
I go 10 to 15.
I mean, they're rocking like Abercrombie cargo pants.
It's
and
like
stuff
going
like
back
that.
To pre-prohibition.
I think that's what's going on over there. Like, we're a little out of touch that California, they're just fucking way more into
cooler here. People.
Yeah, he's probably looking at us.
That's
like,
been known.
Look at these dudes.
It's been known for a while.
These guys look like farmers, like these Midwest guys.
Now that's coming back. Now all the cowboy culture is like taking over. You know, all the guys in SoCal are looking like some modern cowboys.
But so Josh has a theory about that. We were walking around Austin. What was your, you have a whole theory about like,
it's just, it's a pendulum swing.
Yeah.
right? Everything was, once it swings so much one way, you have to go so hard the polar opposite, right? And we were walking around Austin talking about like this talking about, and you know, they've always, I still smoke to this day, right? And you know, it's been, yeah, I know, super cool. I know, I was saying it as a flex. I'm glad, glad you picked up on that.
Oh, yeah, dude.
Yeah. But you know, and it's been so anti, you know, it's a dirty habit, right? And it's looked down upon. It's been super frowned upon.
People are like, oh, you still smoke?
Right.
What's the matter with you?
But now, and we talked about it, this was like 4 years ago, we were in Austin, and I was, you know, there was like a little cowboy shop, and we went and looked at like some cool boots and stuff like that. And I said, I'm telling you, like, everything's going to be coming back. And Austin's definitely progressive and more hipper, right? So you start seeing people, we go to like a restaurant, and like everybody's sitting outside, and like, you've definitely got some
smoking. I forgot.
Yeah, about that. Yeah, you've got some, like, you know, some seriously blue hair hipsters, you know, and they're like in cowboy hats and they're smoking cigarettes, whatever. And I'm like, it's swinging back, you know, because you've got to do the thing. Everybody's looking to be unique, right?
Yeah.
So it's like, you were so one way, you know, and now it's like, I'm gonna be a fucking cowboy and like smoke cigarettes, right? A dipping is, I guarantee you, fucking chewing tobacco is right around the corner of coming back.
I mean, people are doing that. They, in California, they just outlawed all the flavored ones. So like all like the cherry and like bubblegum flavored ones. So so that killed a lot of it. Yeah. I think everyone just like, well, fuck it, I'm gonna zin now.
Yeah, nobody's like, gonna just chew tobacco flavored chewing tobacco.
I know some people that still do. They're like, oh, you fucking pussies. Yeah, I'm glad they outlawed that shit. This wasn't for you anyways. I'm like, all right, you can have it, you know? Like,
a bag of Red Man was always better than a can of dip, but it was the packaging is what killed him.
Red Man?
Yeah. Red Man would only go up on the dash of your truck, right? Yeah. But you couldn't throw a pack of Red Man in your back pocket, but you could throw a can of Copenhagen back there, no problem.
Yeah.
And it made a statement too.
Yeah.
Anyway, the swing of everything going back, you know, and we talk about 80s, 90s, but it's a little more than that. It's like you try to find those cultural things that a few years ago would have been so anti-culture, right? NASCAR fell out of favor, you know, all this different stuff. Well, then you lean, regardless of what your political affiliation or whatever it is, it's like you lean back into Americana because it's been what's so out of vogue for the last few years.
Right. And I think it actually starts to get worn and stuff starts to get done ironically.
Yes.
Like, oh yeah, like, yep. You know, it kind of, you have, what is it? Eastbound and Down, like Kenny Powers. And like, it's like, oh yeah, it's all satire. But then you had some people go, oh, that's cool, I'm going to rock that, I'm going to wear that. And then some people are like, oh, is he serious? Like, oh, that's kind of cool.
Maybe, you know, it is
like,
kind of cool.
Like the mullets and this stuff, like coming back. It's
wearing
like
a Danny McBride shirt right now.
I am wearing a Danny McBride. Rough House Pictures right there.
Yeah.
Car Pranks with Friends.
Yeah. So it's like, I think there's a certain, like, some people just take it and then actually start, they adopt it, you know, when it was done ironically or satirically. And because I like all this baggy stuff, like a few years ago, like,
oh,
he's like ridiculous. But I think again, it's all skinny jeans. And now you should see the size of jeans, like, and it's starting in what I see in SoCal, but it's already moving up to where we're at. I'm like, there's got these kids that are 19 years old rocking these JNCO jeans again. Right. I'm like, holy,
because you
got
to swing
shit
as far opposite. You can't just go to normal jeans because it was the tightest you could get.
Yeah.
Now it's like, watch this. So JNCOs are big. Huge.
Yeah. So
I'm actually kind of looking forward to that because I rocked the shit out of some JNCOs back in the day, but I was like at 13, I didn't even break 100 pounds. So I had to wear kid size JNCOs, and the kid size JNCOs had a different J.
Yeah,
on them. You know, remember they had that little embroidered?
Did people notice?
Nobody ever said anything.
You hit
but
it.
I knew.
You hit
I
the
knew.
J, didn't
yeah,
you?
Self-conscious.
It was,
about
it. It was a lowercase J.
Yeah.
Put some gaffer's tape over it, or buy the actual ones and then cut it off. Yeah,
exactly. So it but at 41, dude, I could rock the adult JNCOs now.
You think
there
so?
There we go. I don't know. I think you got it.
Yeah.
You got to rock the tight shirt and then the JNCOs.
Yeah.
We've all got our goals.
Yeah.
I got one that might be a beer rally. I just did some garage cleaning and found some LBZ pants.
Okay. Yeah, LBZ is a sick brand. I'm surprised that has... I know... I see the comments on the moto stuff, like, bring LBZ back. When some when some throwback stuff gets posted, people are like hyped on the LBZ with like the flames and stuff, and like are the
that's a blue satin with the super hardcore, or not hardcore, super stiff Kevlar inner liners that you couldn't move.
Yeah, that was, I mean, yeah. Yeah, I think, and for us, I think we all grew up in that era, and there was just, you kind of look back on it and you start to be like, okay, yeah, that stuff was cool. You know, you're going back for a feeling, you know, of like how it felt to be like, not just younger, but like you have less responsibilities, and there stuff was just done differently then. It wasn't all the social media, everything wasn't so accessible, and things were just different then. So I think there is some of that's coming back with our generation, because it was like, yeah, that was cool. That's why you have like the third gen Camaros and stuff, or like all that era stuff is now like, when 10 years ago people were like, oh, those are pieces of shit and they're $1,500, you know, all day long. And now it's like, no, those are actually nice cars and you can do cool stuff with them. It's like, it's just stuff with time.
You're obviously big into that, because I like absolutely geek out over your social media, because I'm like, these guys harass me all the time. Like, I'm the dude, I'll show up with like neon shoes on and fucking neon shirts and shit, and they're always busting my balls. And all the stuff I like, it's like, you know, I'm always searching for an 89 Testarossa, a 91 01. Yes. And then I'm flipping around your social media. I'm like, dude, this guy, we're like,
I
fucking
know. He lives.
Like, there's going to be a fucking connection here. I know it. I'm like, dude, a fucking C4 vet next to, what is it, a Scarab?
Yeah, yeah, that's my buddy's boat. Is it a Scarab? I don't even know.
Looked
what it
like
is.
A Scarab, yeah. But I'm like, this is fucking me. I'm like, this is fucking awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I was just like, and I think the caption is like, what a lot of money looked like, like 20 years ago. You know, like, you know, because it is just like a cool setup.
How is it on yours? Deep,
you know, it probably is on mine. That was like a year ago though. So, that style of stuff is super cool.
But I think the attraction's interesting, because we remembered it obviously. So like that car, that was a high performance car. Oh, there's the
zero. Yeah. Well, that's just the LT4. That was the last. That was the last C4. So that's a manual C4 with the LT4, and I was gonna LS swap it and everything, and I was like, this thing is so good stock. I'm like, I just left it.
Why I want the ZR1, dude, because that thing's got some horsepower. You know?
Yeah, I do. I actually want the ZR1 because they're actually wider.
Yeah,
that's like
the
whole
little
like
flares on
yeah.
It.
So it's like, I think they wind it down the middle so it doesn't like look all crazy. It like the license plate is wider.
And oh, so the box really?
Yeah. So they come stock with like 315s. They just got that crazy motor in them. But they're super sick. And then I think something can be done with these for sure.
Absolutely. Like, how badass do you feel when you're driving that?
Because
it fucking looks sick.
It's super. It's super cool. I mean, it just slammed to the ground. It just made me realize like it's such a good car for how much they are right now too. Like it's just.
We were just talking about that this weekend.
I feel like they were made for smaller people though. I'm not that tall, and my head is in the ceiling of this car though. It's like, it is. It is. It's not the most comfortable, but it's so cool. And like, I park it and. You don't see many of those. Many of them aren't that well taken. Actually, they're all kind of all well taken care of. But
the only thing now, there's a few. Super low model. There's a few guys like that would be our age that think it's cool. I still think though that the majority of the people that are gonna like it and come up and talk to you is probably the ones that you don't want to like talk to. It's not like it's a bunch of cool guys. Not a lot of guys. Oh they're, fuck yeah, C4.
No,
it was your dad's car.
Yeah,
when
yeah.
We were
yeah.
Yep.
Of that age.
No one has realized that they're cool yet, because like we did our C4 like license deal with Chevrolet, and people are like, what, the C4? Well, how could you do that year? Where's the C6 one? Do a C7 one, you know? Like, I was just like, I got a C4. I had to do the C4. And it was like kind of like finally there were like a coming of age for the Corvettes. It was actually now competitive with the international boys, and like they use C4 components on all of those resto mods for like decades after that, you know. It was like, it definitely had some good engineering to it. And I opened that thing up and check it out, and I'm like, it's a good car.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah. My dad had, it was like an 89 probably.
It was still the angled back bumper.
Yeah. It was a convertible. So it had that well, you know, like behind the seat.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I remember I was probably like 8 years old or something. and dad was just crushing cocktails, right? And then we're going home.
Smoking
cigarettes with the windows up, and I'm riding in the back, like under the convertible top. I'm like, dad, this is fucking awesome. What a legend. Like, your dad reeks the Crown Royal. Yeah. This is fucking amazing. Like, those are the memories, you know?
Well, my friend's dad was a painter, I think, and he had a black C4, and he had like either one or two 12s in the back of that, and he had a CD player. Ooh. And this friend was older than me. He could drive, and he'd pick me up to go skating, and we'd bump the Wyclef Jean CD in that thing. Yes. And when the bass would come on, I was like, this is so...
You know the CD.
So cool. And it was just
talking
like,
your language.
And it was it was manual, and he would get it sideways, and I was like, this car is so cool. So when I was originally looking for one, I was like, I want the experience, the black C4. That was so badass that we never wrapped that thing around a tree, and it was just so cool to like leave like the skate park or the skate spots in that thing, you know, like, and they're just awesome cars. So you just have these memories with these things, and like they're like little bits and pieces, and you're like, yeah, those things are rad.
Well, it's everything that you've told us up to this point answers a lot of questions that I had along the way.
Okay, so we're done, right?
we're finished. Specifically about the branding side of things, and you talked about, you know, you were doing that vintage NASCAR stuff way back when. This is stuff that you were into. This is stuff that you lived, and you guys stayed into it. So it explains to me why this stuff is, because everybody's tried to do 80s and 90s. A lot of people have tried to do, in the last few years, tried to do 80s and 90s, right? But there's when you see it done right,
when it's authentic,
it explains it. When you see it and you're like, holy fuck, how did they just nail it so right? Especially, and we'll get to the car, the greatest car that you own, and I want to hear the story about that.
Okay.
Because that's the coolest fucking thing.
I know where you're going with it.
I'm from Alabama.
Save
so
it. Okay.
You can. I'm sure you can pick the.
Probably a Buick.
Yeah, that's absolutely the Buick. Anyway, so you see the stuff, and everything is just done right. I mean, you see the heartbeat stuff, you see the stuff, and you've seen it done wrong. You guys, maybe you talked about you had a graphic design thing. Hats off to you guys, because everything is just so fucking right, no matter what. And it would be easy to do it cliche, not for you guys, but it's easy to go that direction in marketing and do it cliche. It's also easy to go down, you know, four-wheel drive and racing and vintage NASCAR and some of that 80s stuff and start to get a little too dirtbag.
Yeah.
You still have to have an elevated brand feel.
Right, yeah. And that's constantly what we're, I would say, battling with is, how do you adopt that aesthetic and not just be a dirtbag, like you said. Because at the end of the day, like, we are trying to sell a product, and if it's just all for shits and giggles and like everything's a joke and no one takes the product seriously, then you're not going to sell shit. It's just like, Instagram's funny, like, I follow them for that, you know, like.
Well, I mean, I think you absolutely nailed it. I've bought your product.
Okay, before. Thank you.
And, you know, me, I mean, I'm 41. I'm an entrepreneur, would you say?
Yeah.
Like an entrepreneur, right?
Yeah.
And, you still know,
wear,
I'm probably...
Still wear child's
jinkos. Yeah, but I'm probably like a little bit... I'm probably a little bit outside the demographic that I would imagine that you're marketing to. But, like, you fucking hooked me, man. And then I got on the website, and you could build the glasses and stuff. I'm like, this is fucking awesome.
Yeah, I don't think you're outside the demographic. I think you are the demographic, because we're kind of hitting on the heartstrings of this stuff that was... cool, or was like, it was part of our upbringing, and it, since the way that we're doing it, it's like, it is resonating with you, like that's absolutely what we're going after, like. And there's people that have bigger brands that are adopting the style and probably selling that to the younger kids that were never part of that stuff too, right. And we're obviously trying to sell the aesthetic to everybody, but I would say a majority of our demographic that is enjoying the stuff, to like you said, is it has lived it, you know, right. Is part of it. Like, our demographic is definitely a little bit older, and I would say closer to your age is probably about where kind of gets about my age or a little bit older, and that's about it. But yeah, I would say that it is.
I wonder from a marketing standpoint, which is, you know, probably just an interesting conversation for you. Like, it came in front of me because Josh found it, right? And I mean, it's an awesome fucking brand. And now that I know about it, I feel like it's everywhere. But I wonder why it did, like, why I didn't stumble across it, you know, like the thinking through your demographic and how you find your demographic. Like, why did I not? And it's probably 3 years ago. I think I bought some glasses from you. Like, I wonder why in this day and age where you say something and 20 minutes or 20 seconds later, it pops up on your fucking social media.
Why you didn't find it sooner?
Why it didn't hit me?
Because we were so focused on developing product and not pushing the brand in the early years that we did not take advantage of the wild west of Instagram and Facebook marketing, okay, where some other brands really got out in front of marketing, you know, and didn't have to, they used stuff that was already available in China and slapped their stickers on it and, gotcha, and put that, the single lens style out there and just hit the marketing hard, where we were, all of our stuff, we have integrity. We're developing our stuff from the ground up, you know, and we spent a lot of time on that. And then we didn't have the resources to then market it at that capacity. You know, we're like, okay. So that's probably why it took a little bit of time. And I think it kind of came with maturity. Like if we would have blown up early on, it would have probably been a detriment to the brand. So I think everything is kind of on a proper trajectory. So
nice.
Well, the whole team, I mean, seriously, I know it comes from the top, but your guys really handle themselves seemingly. I don't know them, right? But I'm looking at social media. Through the lens of social media, specifically Instagram, we've talked about this a lot, and I touched on it earlier. It's so important to be the corporation that you have confidence in, being like, oh, it's a company. They're not going to just take my money. I'm going to get a good product, right? So it's a business. It's of prominence. And then it's like, oh, they do such cool shit, right? So it's a cool company. But then there's the, well, there's a human being on the other side. I can talk to a human being. And you do that on your social media, specifically the stuff that you, I don't know if it's your social media manager or whatever, where it's all the people asking for free shit. Yeah. And the way they handle this, it's so fucking awesome, because everybody's in on the joke.
Right.
You're not laughing at the guy.
Right.
We're all laughing together. Right. Right? And they call out, like they'll show a DM of so-and-so is asking for, you know, hey, send me a free pair of these. Right. Yeah. And then the like screenshots of all the DMs back and forth. Well, we will if you do this, 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 and this, and all this. And it's so great to see everyone's like, oh, there's like human beings there. Right.
Right.
But we've talked about this a lot. When you see a comment on something, whatever, you're like, man, I really want to say like this, right? But then you overanalyze. You're like, man, it could come across this way. And then there's like six people that are going to take it the wrong way. And they're going to be like, I can't believe you just didn't send a free set of glasses or what, you know? And
yeah,
it's weird.
Yeah, it is. So I had done all of that up until like very recently. I'd run the social media for Heatwave since probably 2013. And then I got some guys in there now that I've kind of said, hey, you can kind of say this. Can they'll see kind of, I'll hop on and I'll respond to stuff. I'll just straight up say like, no, you know, like, and I say, you got to look for gold in the DMs. Like it's always there. It's always there. Like, see, and I had done some stuff back in the day that even it performed like so well, like, and just like twisting these people, like spending like a whole day like messing with somebody, like, and but then like no one's on their side, like everyone, yeah, the people like love these DM, like if you, there's a kind of like a secret of things that will work on social media right now, and this stuff is, you got to be careful with it, because you start posting this stuff all the time and you will not be able to post product, like, because Instagram is, then they want you to post what's doing well for the engagement. And so you start to move away and just posting more like mean this stuff. And
have you read this?
Like, yeah. It's great, because it's great for engagement. Everyone loves it. And the twist at the end, or the little stingers at the end, are so good. And then this just creates like a firestorm in the DMs of everyone asking for free shit then too. So it just kind of, one leads to another, and like, but there's always like stories that you can kind of make, and yeah, Caden right now is having a blast and doing a great job with these, because I will, there's been times in the past where I'm like, dude, don't do that. But like, yeah, this stuff, I'm like, not, don't even have a part of it. I'm like, okay, you get it. Like, but You got to be careful because you can easily get yourself into trouble. And I've done some stuff where we used to post, you do this thing like shout out Saturdays and stuff when you could shout out people and people responded
to
it.
You can still do it.
Jeremy does it on this podcast all the time.
Nobody cares. Like stuff that worked 2 years ago does not work now. It's like ever evolving and stuff that worked 5 years ago fantastically, like definitely doesn't work now. But like people wonder why we don't like share more photos. Like it just doesn't do well. And then we have people like bomb on people that we post. So you got to be careful with that. And then you kind of take something and you make up your own caption and then someone's doing something weird in the photo and someone gets the wrong idea and shares it with the wrong group. I've like spent entire days like trying to like smooth things over, you know, like, and you're just like, what did I do? You know, like, people like, and you get these certain comments that like sting, like, oh, I've been following the brand for a long time. I thought you guys were really on the way up. And like, after seeing this post, I just don't think you guys got what it takes. Like I'm unfollowing. Like, yeah. And you're just like,
dude, I think that's a missed opportunity. That's the DM that you fuck with.
Yeah. I don't know. No, like you got to look at the percentage. Like, is it like 10% of people are mad or is it like 90%? If it's 90%, you're like, time to take this one down. Luckily it doesn't happen too often, but there is just those kind of things that sit in the back of your head from those experiences. Right now, it's like these guys haven't dealt with that backlash. So, and also, they don't care if it's like, oh, I killed the brand. Like, so what? I just killed it for the rest of the guys. Yeah, who cares?
But it is weird. I can't imagine in your space because, you know, your product either is static on a table or it's got to be on a human being, right?
Yeah.
So you're utilizing human beings, whether it's a customer, you know, or it's thing, and the internet is. I don't know if you know this or not. It's not really an inviting place, right? They're not kind.
Yeah, it can be bad. I would say the worst thing is the indifference, though. Like, or if the algorithm, like, I would rather have people say, like, that looks like shit, like, or that's stupid, than you get the zero comments, like 120 likes. You're like, ooh, like it was so bad. No, everyone just kind of walked out of the room. Even the algorithm didn't like it. You're like, okay, I'm not gonna post that again. Like. The indifference is always worse because growing up as a rollerblader, I can take like the shit talking. Like if people want to bomb on me all day long, like it built a thick skin, you know? So
I meant more about like the people that are in there. Like you could put a person in there with a pair of glasses, whatever,
slammed on,
and everyone just, and then all it takes is one negative comment and then everybody just starts rolls.
If,
like,
if that's the top comment, then people are, or it's the first comment, like, and people are just like, it's the hive mind stuff. So it can kind of run away.
Great glasses, but she's mid.
You're like, damn it. Like you just gotta, we do. And I tell the guys like, hey, if we're posting people's stuff or if it's an ad, a UGC ad with somebody, like you got to police comments on there. You got to pull, because the last thing we want to get them is like self-conscious and being like, I don't want to give Heatwave my stuff anymore. Their customers or their commenters or their followers are a bunch of like immature dicks. Like, so.
Well, that's the other side of like you interacting and it creates that space of like, oh, this is fun.
Yeah.
Like we all can like, you know, have, you know, banter back and forth. And then it's always that guy that wants to like, you know, go a little too far.
Yeah, I mean, we deal with that stuff all the time. And yeah, like our followers are, for the most part, great. You know, I don't want to say that they're immature dicks, but the last thing you want to do is have someone recoil from the brand because they got a comment and they feel that, you know, that's what people who are behind, thank you, that people that are rocking the brand are all like that. Oh, you got to reach a little harder there.
Yeah, for it.
So it's something that you constantly has to be monitored in the social media thing. I mean, we have, 300,000 something followers now. And this has not been something that has been achieved overnight.
Dude, you're at 321 right now after this podcast.
Don't you guys?
You'll probably still be at 321.
Yeah, probably lose a couple. Yeah. You'll probably get some people to jump off.
We never went that way.
Yeah.
We're always promoting that we'll get you at least 20, 30. But
well, they only count the thousands right now. So, like, you're not going to notice if you lose 300, 400.
Or three. Yeah. Like, but yeah, it's taken a full decade, you know, plus to build that up. So if that were to get like taken away overnight, like this is our most visible channel, it would just be like,
it'd be catastrophic. Damn.
Like, I think we would still be kind of okay, but it would take a long time to build that back, and it would definitely impact. I can't say the percent. It'd be maybe, it could be like 20 to 80%, you know, like who knows? Yep. It definitely impacted. We've spent a lot of time building this thing up. It's not something that came easy.
What would you lean into that trash talking, just like a roast me, put your glasses on?
Yeah, like
that's been like a huge comedy thing lately. It's like start the general roast. I can see
that going real bad.
Yeah, I mean,
it's pretty entertaining.
If it was me, I wouldn't have a problem with it. I might get a little self-conscious after that. Just like, haha, yeah, yeah. And then it's just like, oh, damn, never doing that again.
Never mind.
Like,
I never noticed it.
I think it's time to get out of here. My time is, but you just got to be careful. I mean, we're posting other people, and there's people that do not care or get on there after they've had a few to drink and just start lighting people up. And I mean, and sometimes we take those people and put them on blast, but it's... because we got we run a lot of ads now, and a lot of people leave comments on there that they can't even get back to because it was in their feed, and then we can post that stuff. So they can't even take it down.
Back in the day when you were really starting to get rolling, you were doing in person sales and internet sales, and you were how at that price point of that product, and you're trying to. How do you get authentic feedback from those customers about the product and try to learn how to improve there and know what to trust?
Just by talking to people. Well, the in-person events, I knew that we had to do that because no one was going to find the website and randomly on the internet. And so we had to show up, and then just by what people are buying and... Yeah, just we talk to people. We talk to racers. We talk to race teams. We talk to spectators. We talk to random people strolling through the event. You know, like, so, and it was us. I mean, I've done over 100 of these events where we're packing up for the weekend and going there and then coming back at 3:00 in the morning on Sunday night and going back to work on Monday morning, you know, like, and like 100 plus of these events, like, is a lot of your life.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, I'm sure you guys have done the same thing. Yeah. So,
Chrome Carnival for years.
Yeah. So, carnies.
Yeah. So, you see what's selling out there, and so you're able to do that. And then, I would say the online is just that, but a little distilled, you know, like it's a little more, narrow down, you know, like people stay a little bit safer when it comes to the online stuff because they can't see it, they can't feel it, they can't try it, they are not drinking, so there is the drunk buying, maybe, but for the most part, yeah, I think people are a little more cautious when they're online, even though we can make this stuff look a lot better, but they can't try it on and stuff. So yeah, and I was running DMs and the Instagram and monitoring all the comments for over a decade. So, and still, I'm still on there. So I'm seeing all those comments, people commenting and DMing about like, I wish the arm wasn't like this, or this grabs my hair. Like, how about this? And I'm like, okay, I need to develop that. I need to work on that. And that's, you know, like how the new performance line came about is like people saying, oh, they love the arms of the future tech and stuff. It's like, okay, how can we make this previous product that's selling well, people love, like, even better, taking what people love about this product and combining it, you know, stuff like, so it's just, I think it's me not disconnecting myself from the customer and the business, like, at all, and just constantly, whether it's at the event, and I have a great events team now, luckily, because you can only do so much by yourself, as you guys know, that if you can't hire that out, you can never grow. So you just have to find the right people that can then kind of lead the charge. There you go, set them up with it. And then they're listening too and kind of reiterating that stuff back to me. But I'm still kind of at this main focal point of this channel, like listening and trying to fix things.
Yeah. That's what I wanted to get. Like I'm interested in, if you're doing a, you know, music event, or you're doing, you know, a live event and you sell, you know, several hundred pairs back in the day, you know, and you talk to, you know, 50, 60 people and everybody kind of talks on the drive home and you're like, you know, everybody said they really liked these, right? You can get a subset of like, you know, roughly numbers, you know, 40% of the people really like the hot pink, you know, and then as you progress, you know, you start looking at, well, I've sold, you know, 50,000 pairs of these this month, you know, and I've got 3 comments of somebody saying, you know, they don't like the way it fits the bridge of their nose. So how that subset, you know, that percentage, you're like, well,
Right, get a fucked up nose.
You know, well,
there's got to be at least three people with fucked
you,
up noses.
You have to take, you know, you have to continue to, like you said, be in contact with your customers, but that algorithm changes, you know, or that those percentage changes. Like, well, shit, I talked to like 60% of my customers, 50% of my customers at that event, and now I know how many we've sold, and I haven't really heard this complaint before, but I need to look at that. You can't throw everything out, but it changes your mentality of being like, well, shit, I've sold a shit ton of these things. This is the first time I've heard about it. But then you also don't want to like dismiss something that maybe it's a manufacturing issue or something like that. Of, oh, shit, they did get a little tighter or something.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we're dealing with stuff changing like that all the time. So you take each complaint or piece of feedback and you're like, okay, like, and you just got to kind of weigh it. And if there's multiple people saying it, you're like, okay, we have an issue. But if it's one person, you're like, okay, maybe it's a particular defect. And you just try and you communicate with the customer and try and, you know, like just take care of them from like in not like a help desk, like automated thing, like, oh, with a canned answer or whatever. You like, you take care of them to make sure that they know that there's a real person behind the brand and someone that knows the product. And then you just got to weigh up what severity is, because this stuff is not easy to fix. We're talking, we got, you know, hundreds of thousands of pieces like on a shelf at a time, you know. It's like, so it could take, I mean, something that sells slow, it could take, you know, a year or two to get through that, or you know, with some of the slower selling stuff even longer, or you want to make, now we have this issue because a lot of the stuff is customizable and cross compatible, like you want to change something, it could affect everything that's already out there on in people's hands, like, because then you replace the replacement parts and now they can't get what they need. You know, it's like changing like a bolt pattern on like a wheel all of a sudden. It's just like, well, now the whole aftermarket's like screwed up. Like, so we really have to take that into account, like how bad is this? And luckily there hasn't been any issues that we can't solve. And we had to be super scrappy in the beginning because we did have all these pink and blue frames that, and people weren't buying them. It's like, but what do people like black? It's like, okay, what, we can paint the top half of the frame black and we'll fade. They like subtle color, like the colors on the arms are doing well, like little, they like the colored lenses. It's like, get this gun paint that's super durable, paint the tops half of the frames, call them faders, and we're selling frames that just now have like a hint of color on the bottom. So it's like, flip that product, and then it comes with a black arm. You flip that into a mostly black product with a hint of color when this full thing wouldn't sell. And then we couldn't keep the product fresh in the beginning because we had to order so much of it. The quantities were so high. It's like, how do you keep people excited? So I found a place local to us that could print on the arms. And luckily he was super willing to work with us because no one was willing to work with us. So it's like, okay, now we're able to inject freshness as often as we wanted to, with, you know, we do an American flag arm print. We do a different color in the American flag. We do a different splatter. We do something that's themed after like some Ford Motorsport thing, you know, like,
that's cool.
Like, you know, so it's, we were able to do that when we weren't, when we weren't focused on filling the fulfillment side of things, we were able to like fix a lot of problems like early on. Like a huge shipment came when we found a new manufacturer, all the hinges would wipe out like right away. It's like, oh my God, we got, and they were like, yeah, you approved this. Like, what can we do? And we need that product to sell right now. We had to like find stainless steel dowels, make a jig, like drill the hinge out, like press the stainless steel dowels into the hinge with a press and a tool to where it wouldn't go through all the way. And like, they were like too long, 'cause we just had to get something from like McMaster Car that was like standard. And we're all of our tolerances are sub 1 millimeter. So it's like, and that it wouldn't shear the nubs anymore, but it would like, it was hard on the arms. We had to figure out ways to like get over this stuff or like immediately. Otherwise we were like dead in the water.
Well, there goes the profit margins.
Yeah. I mean, we were sitting there like assembling, glasses, but it didn't matter. It was never really about the money. Like, the money was important to keep it going, but we wanted to be proud selling the product and wanted people to like come back, you know. It's like, but if they got something that was inferior, we knew the money would never come.
Just take care of whatever it takes.
So that and I think we were all willing to put in the extra mile, and still are, to make that customer happy and make that product something that we would stand behind, you know, whatever we had to do, you know, like, and I had done that previously in the other business. He got jackets we're selling that are like supposed to be waterproof tape seams. They didn't heat the seams up enough in the jacket. I spent days like ironing the seams in those jackets myself. And I think it was only like 100 jackets or something like that. I've made no money on those, but it's just like, yeah, I said that these had fully taped seams. Like, I'm going to fix this. And it's the same thing with the glasses. Like, and now it's like, if there is an issue and it's like, we got to junk a couple thousand pairs of glasses because there could be a potential issue. It's like, yeah. And we could sell it. And we have micro scratches on the lens that no one's ever going to see. It's like, yeah, that doesn't meet our quality standards. Like, right there, getting junked. So
when did you start to realize that the palm tree logo could stand alone without the heat wave? Because you see that now, and I see it. Yeah, everybody, you know what it is.
It's the Nike swoosh.
Yeah. But that takes time to get there.
I knew right away when my partner had designed it that we had a killer logo. That's why when we change it from Party Shades, I was like, we're keeping the logo. You know, like, we have a great logo. And we couldn't change it. It was like molded into the arm. But we just knew that.
Or carved into a pumpkin.
Yeah. Or carved into a pumpkin, yeah.
It's just a cool logo. It's like asymmetrical, which is a lot of like the design language that we kind of pump into the brand that's in a lot of the stuff. And it's just, but it is, it's kind of a circle. But yeah, it's just super cool, you know. And like, and a lot of brands have done palm trees. But yeah, I saw it and I just knew it was a great logo.
It's interesting that the Roadster Shop logo originally started as two palm trees.
Really?
Because it was a special touch of California, Elgin, Illinois. Yeah. This is like way back in the day. And it just didn't hit for some reason.
Yeah.
It's hard to believe.
I guess, right? Yeah.
But I've got the old sign sitting up in the mezzanine.
We've got a neon pink windbreaker.
Yeah,
I think in the office over there.
Oh, sick. Was that you guys did that, or was that pre
that, that was pre us.
Okay.
So that would have been like, I mean, you're talking like late 80s into the 90s.
Okay. I mean, there's not a single palm tree out here.
No.
And that it was a pretty localized thing. I mean, it was the Midwest.
It was before the internet.
Yeah, yeah.
So but it was at that point in time, there was like, you know, hot rod shops were, there really wasn't anything in like the, it was Midwest. It was all located.
Yeah, it was all California.
It was all flames and stuff like that. Yeah, like, yeah. But palm trees, yeah, okay. I mean, but you guys are headed.
We'll fucking bring it back.
Yeah. Yeah.
You mentioned talking about cars and always been into cars. Was the twin turbo Chevelle the first purchase when you started being like, oh, yeah, I'm making a little bit of money, I'm ready to do something fun?
No, that was like pre-money. That was the stupidest thing I ever like could have done. Yeah. Stupidest thing. Okay, so my first car was a... My dad gave it to me.
Don't tell us what it is.
Hey, we're going
to
touch
it. Yeah, we touch on that at the end. We're going to try to guess.
Oh, okay.
So don't
talk
about the first car.
So second
car was then a 70 Chevelle. And I had that in high school. And, you know, like after like Fast and the Furious came out, like Root Supercharged stuff. And I had bought like was all cool. Like Pro Street was coming to life. Like, and this had to be in like 2000, you know, like, yeah, it had to be in 2000.
65.
It was like a four-inch cowl with a, you know, catalog bought SBC in it, like some crappy headers with some Flowmasters. I thought I was the shit in that car, you know, like, and then like as cars started getting, and I would street race that, and you know, 400 horsepower was a shit ton.
Oh, man,
with
shit.
A demon carburetor and everything.
Hell yeah.
Edelbrock intake. Like, I was the shit. I had like a little, I had a nitrous system on it. So I thought I was the hot shit with that. But then, these big tire cars and supercharged cars started showing up. I was like, okay, that's next for me. I was like, okay, it doesn't make sense to redo this 70. I was like, I'm gonna start over. I can sell this. I think those cars were super cheap then. Like, I bought that car for $5,000 and sold it for $14,000. And then I was like, yeah, I'm just gonna buy a roller that's already done, like a back half car, and buy a used supercharged motor off of eBay. I'm gonna have this thing running and. 3 months, 6 months.
6 years later.
No, it was
famous last
been
words.
20 years, 20 something years. So that's the story of that. So I had this car like right out of high school. And
that's
no,
a nasty looking fucking Chevelle.
And it was not when I had any type of money. I stupidly spent every single dime I had on this thing. And it got to a point where I couldn't finish it. So I went to a shop to get the cage finished and the exhaust finished. And it turns out it was, that little bit of damage on the quarter panel, it was in a wreck and it got the frame bent. So it needs a new frame. And then it started with like, okay, it needs a new frame. Like it's been like a couple like the pro street cars at the time were like channeling the bodies over the frames. Oh, like, shit. Okay, let's not, since we have to do this, you might as well do this. Like, and it just snowballed. That guy ended up closing his shop, and then it went to this nightmare shop that had it for another decade plus. And that car was painted that color in 2012. And I was, for a bit there, I was hoping no one called me to ask me to pay for anything on it because I had no money. Like, you know, it's one of those, like, yeah, don't hit me up. And yeah, it was at a bad shop, and I wish I never would have got into this because this car added so much stress to my life at the time. And this car was like designed in the early to like late 2000s. So it was like pre like everyone LS swapping everything.
Yeah, there wasn't a lot of good shit out there then.
Yeah, it was. And so it's like no one was really doing twin turbos at the time. You had Nelson who had kind of just come on the scene that was doing it. Like all the EFI was all, I mean, people were still dumping turbos through carburetors at the time. Yeah. And I didn't know anything about turbos, and the guy who was building is like, oh yeah, you have to build exhaust anyways, like for this supercharger. I just bought a BDS supercharger and I was like, yeah, let's do this. He's like, yeah, you have to build exhaust anyways. Like I'll trade this supercharger for turbos and we'll just, I'm like, sure. If you can say you can do it, let's do it. Like, God damn it.
Yeah, turbos are always a spendy upgrade. I mean, there's a lot.
There's a lot more tubing and stuff like that. I don't think I was ever going to get out of there unless I like forcefully took my car out of that shop. I didn't know any better and it had gotten away from me. But this car actually did something. I saw the work that they were doing there and I was like, okay, it's actually like, that's cool stuff, but you got to actually practice that. And I got this car was away for so long, you know, when you got a car in a shop and you're like, forget about it, you're like, I got room to get something else, you know.
I've got one of those going on right now.
I got it. You make room to get rid of stuff because you know you got to get rid of it. Then you're like, well, I got a space here now. So I got a 65 Lincoln Continental from the East Coast, another nice. Sight unseen. From the East Coast. And this guy goes,
awesome car.
This guy
build.
Goes, hey, this guy goes, yeah.
You know, just got to get the top working.
It's beautiful. Terrible. It's a great DIY project.
Yeah. Yeah, so I bought killer this car. Thing from New York. He said, oh, it's been sitting for a decade. Some guy owed me money. I just took his car. It's the original paint. It was like in the 2000s, the pictures on eBay were like this big. I'm like, it's got he pointed out this like little chip in the door. He's like, that's it. I'm like, cool. Got it here. It was so bad. Like I hired like the nicest, like I hired horseless carriage to bring it out, like a nice like like van, like nice like high end car.
Yeah, you thought you were getting
and
something.
And again, he's like so pissed when he pulls up to the shop. He's just like, this thing's leaking brake fluid all over the car underneath of it. So it had no brakes when he pulled it. I was like, holy shit! Like this car underneath of it is now destroyed. Like nice, I forget what it was, but it was like maybe like a nice Mustang with a perfect paint job with brake fluid.
Was perfect.
I was like, holy shit. And so long story short, I learned to do all my welding and everything on that Lincoln Continental. So like, I didn't know how to do it, but that car forced me to, cause I had to cut out all the fenders, the trunk, like the floors, and they don't make replacement body panels. So I had to make all my floor pans. I had to like get a bead roller and just doing all that in my garage and made like gigantic wheel tubs. Cause I was going to like, this is when Dub Magazine was cool. I was like, I'm going to tub this. I'm going to 24s on this, an air ride. And then I got it running and I just put the stock wheels and tires on it. And I had just put like lowering blocks and I built the exhaust for it. It was all MIG welded and everything. So it was nothing. I didn't get into TIG. It was pre when TIG was everything. And I was like, it actually drove so nice. And I was so proud of my exhaust job. It was like super tucked and it drove. There it is. That's like the last little bit of it there. Nice, like matrix blacked out Lincoln Continental. And I kept the white walls on it. And so that Chevelle being away and seeing what people were doing got me to learn how to like do all my own mechanic work and fabrication. That's work. Cool. More to it because my dad wasn't into working on his own cars at all. So I didn't have anyone to learn from. So I just had to teach myself just like I kind of did with everything else. And this car was how I taught myself. And then I I got busy and wasn't able to drive it that much anymore. And a lot of the new stuff I put on it started failing. And those cars, I think are just a massive pain in the ass.
It's like, a fucking nightmare.
It's so hard to work on, like a 6-volt dash and like hydraulics.
BMW and Mercedes should have just collabed and built it, and it would have been easier to work on.
But this was like the last car where like one person was like responsible for like the entire design of the entire thing. And it was, there's so many, it has way too much tech for 1965.
And that dude forgot to tell anybody how to service it. Yeah. That dude died.
Yes.
And never told anybody how to fuck with this stuff.
It's a nightmare. And there's like, and so it's like scary, like working on the thing and just the things you have to take off to get to the simplest things. I was just like, oh my God, I do not want to work. And I thought I was being a pussy. I was like, because this is like,
you started on the work, yeah. the hardest.
I was being a pussy. I was like, I'm just a bitch. I'm like, but my hand, if it was any bigger, how would you get it in there? I'm like, I don't have that big of hands. And then I started going on the forums, and people were saying like, oh, I brought this car to my mechanic. He said, don't ever bring it here again. I'm like, okay, so it's a common thing. And then, and I shit you not, I was driving it, and then the rear left window rolls itself down one day. And I was like, okay, like, roll it back up, like rolls itself down again, like go inspect the wiring. It's like all good. Like disconnect the window switch, rolls itself down again. I was like, I'm done with this thing. Like, and it was like, that was like the final thing. I was like, it's all good. And it had to be parked outside because I think I had just gotten the GTA in 2017. I was like, this car is not going to last outside because it had been repainted at some point. It was under a car cover. It was getting beat up. I was like, it's either going to go somewhere now when it's still halfway nice, or it's just going to die outside, you know? So I sold it for $15,000 and just so it could go to a home where someone was going to take care of it and appreciate it. Or I don't know where it's at now. It got to the point where it needed, like everyone's like, who cares about this stupid Lincoln? It needed to be painted, but it, with the amount of body work and stuff, you need paint and interior. I was like, I could buy one that's already like redone for the amount I'm going to spend.
That's
for paint interior.
That's the best thing you can do with those cars, because I love them.
Yeah.
And I would buy the right car.
Yes.
Just to get it out of my system.
Yeah.
But I've probably turned down a half dozen builds.
Yeah.
Guys inquiring about building those.
Yeah.
Even like good customers. And I'm like, no, dude, you don't want to do that.
Yeah. And Nate hits us up like every 6 months. So next one, I want to do the Lincoln. Yeah, we're not doing the Lincoln.
It's crazy.
I really want to do when I found
until
one.
Until Bezos calls. And he's like, I'm ready to spend half of my net worth and build a car.
And then we'll farm it out to somebody else to do all the hard work.
Yeah, I see these shops like putting like big horsepower motors and stuff in them too. I'm like, why? This is such a great cruiser car, and like you're taking it and turning it into a race car, which it will never be.
No.
Or like Fender Exit exhaust on it. Like they are such cool cars to cruise in when they're working.
Yeah.
And they're just not race. They're too big to be race cars. But to each their own, you know, like maybe a rip down a drag strip, but I get kind of the juxtaposition there. But that car on white walls, like lowered, it's like,
so good.
Like on the stock wheels. And I'm not like a big stock person, but when I put those stock wheels on there, I was like, this looks so good, I cannot change it.
Oh, it's...
I will own one absolutely in my lifetime because I love the car.
Yeah.
It's fucking gorgeous. And I have a difficult time deciding the year because they're sick from, like, what, 63 up to, 70,
all
basically?
Of them.
Yeah. Yeah, 65, I think, is my favorite because that's the only one that had that grill style in it that's, like, a little bit more straight up. Like, the 62, 63s had the rounded grill, and the 67s, the dash starts to get really, like, big. And, I mean, you guys could do
I like a, a 67. I like a 67. Yeah. But, the 63, it's a different car, but there's cool shit about it, too. Yeah. You're like, oh, man, it's kind of, you know...
Yeah.
It's one of those cars too when you find a really clean, untouched original one. It's got that refrigerator door
style. Yes.
Like you close the doors and you're like, don't if you ever touch this car, if you like adjust the bumper, that's never gonna do that again.
The bumpers are like flush on those cars too. They're not like the classic 60s and 70s car where they're like a Nova where they're sticking out that far, or like even like the later 70s cars.
Gorgeous car.
The design of it is so good. Aesthetically, but like to work on them. Oh, and that car, I spent my entire summer that year grinding off the undercoating on the underneath of it. I'm sure I'm going to live about 20 years less because I inhaled that like 50s era like undercoating.
That's pure asbestos. This is all before wiping kids.
Carcinogen. Yes. Yeah. I mean, I've considered myself like a little bit more or fairly articulate and a little bit sharper before that. And at this, after that, I'm like, something happened. And the worst part was this is like when poor 15 was the shit to do. Like I put they said, we want you to put the silver shit down first before you put the black stuff down. And maybe I messed up somewhere.
That's mercury. That's basically mercury.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I have a lead and mercury poisoning and it did the whole inside. It was immaculate. And then I like put their adhesion promoter primer on it and then did the black under it. And then I go to like install a part like a week later and it like, I can just like scratch the paint off. I'm like, no. I was like, what happened? I call them. They're just like, I don't know.
Dude, like, we had a guy that worked here years ago that was building a Nova and he bought brand new floor pans that came with E-coat on them. And I'm looking over there one day and he's grinding the E-coat off, like aggressively grinding it off. And then he soaked them in water. Right?
Water.
And put them outside so that they would get surface rust on them because he had heard that poor 15 will adhere to surface rust.
Right? Yeah,
yeah, but that's if you have it. You don't try to make it.
You know that.
But you throw some salt on it, too.
Yeah. Are you serious?
No, 100%. Yeah.
No, that's what it said. It has a better tooth to it.
Yeah, it's got a better tooth.
Yeah. But then I had to grind off this whole layer of poor 15, the whole black layer. Like, and so I spent another 3 months under there, like inhaling that. And I would wear like I did it shitty style. I had like the M95 mask. I'm doing this good. And then I pull my mask off at the end of the day. You could just see all the paint, going straight.
Doing like green Rolock, like 36 grit Rolock disc, or
did you get a torch out, heating it up?
I was heating up all the sealant and pulling all that out with
it's
a pick.
It's the fucking best way
with B12 chem tool. And I've like, that's when I found out like a whole tray of B12 chem tool. If you have like your wire brush in it, like the flies like walk down they love B12.
Really?
They just go down to it like it's a swimming pool and like dip their like.
That mask will prevent life-threatening illnesses. So like it will absolutely shield you from the toxic chemicals on 65-year-old undercoat.
So I'm like, this was a huge mistake. Like, yeah, my ailments are still yet to be discovered from that, but I at least knew what, like a grave mistake I had made, but I did get it coated again. It wasn't as shiny and as fantastic after that, but I did do the underside of the car super nice.
There's very few men out there that know the feeling, and maybe women too, that know that feeling of working late or out, you know, either at the shop, driving home or in your home garage, doing that type of stuff and that blow your nose in the shower.
Oh yeah.
And you're like,
pure black.
Oh man.
That and grinder dust.
I thought I did a pretty good job. That's
the only thing.
If that's what got the nose caught, there's a lot more that didn't. Yeah.
The only thing worse than that is when you're grinding, like finishing aluminum or building anything out of aluminum.
That stuff goes. I mean,
the aluminum powder just fills. At least me. I'm like a nose. It fills your fucking nose.
Yeah.
And I forget where I was at.
That's fine dust too.
Some doctor's appointment. Something they were asking if you'd ever had like any exposure, any sort of like metals. For like 20 years, I've just been like inhaling fucking metal.
No, that explains it.
Yeah, this stuff's gnarly.
That's what they said.
But that shit'll fuck you up. I did my Camaro. I did when I was a kid. That was pre undercoat when like bedline and stuff was cool. Laid in the garage, fucking ground off all that undercoating, you know, on a 1969 Camaro, and then hit it with the Eastwood chassis black.
Mm-hmm.
That was when I discovered. Nobody told me that like you can't inhale that. Like you need to put a mask on.
Yeah.
And I remember laying under the car, and I'm like, whoa.
High as shit.
Like, I feel like fuck. I feel like I do when I drink all that, like, tequila. And, like, I'm kind of fucked up, you know? And I remember, like, stumbling out of the garage and, like, sitting there and, like, ooh.
There was so much undercoating because they had put like aluminum flashing in the wheel wells and then just like gooped up like some type of undercoating in there. And I was trying everything I could to strip it. I got Jasco from Home Depot where you like, it's like to remove like, layers and layers of house paint and stuff like that. And you put it on and you apply it with like a real thick coarse brush and then put the paper over it. And I was under there grinding that stuff off for a whole day or trying to pull that off that it We got what I call, we call Jasco fever. I was like on my couch for like 6 hours, like shivering. It's like, I mean, we got that and the Galvi shakes from welding on galvanized.
The Galvi shakes.
Yeah, that's
he's got a lot of, he got a lot of names and stuff. Like,
dude, we have to do a lot. You know, we build a lot of these like survivor type cars where we're not touching the exterior. So we have to strip the undercoating without harming the outside of the car. So some of them you get lucky, like we started dry ice blasting them.
Yeah, yeah, that's nice.
It, but, dude, it is like, I mean, it's 50-50. Either you hit it with the dry ice and it's coming off, or you hit it with the dry ice and it's just like...
It's absorbing
fuck
it.
Fuck you. Yeah. I'm not going anywhere. I've been on here for 50 years, and I'm going to fucking stay on here.
Yeah.
But you, like, the dudes that take that off are absolute troopers, because it is days.
Yes.
Days upon days with every tool. There's not a magic tool. No. It's a combination of every tool.
Yes.
It's... fucking propane torch with the, you know, putty knives and gas,
and it'll go and go until it stops and it doesn't go anymore. And then
you got your corners, and you got to get your smaller wheels to get the corners, and you're always dropping grinders in your laps or like breaking blades. And
I remember our first big the Chevelle. We've talked about it many times on here. That Chevelle, that was our first big build, had and get interior done last minute to get it to Shades. So I had to help the guy do the thought of the interior, right? And we were there late one Friday night or whatever, you know, wife and kids are pissed off and we're working. It's like 2 o'clock in the morning. We're doing something in the headliner. Right. And I'd been around upholstery stuff before, right. Around the glue,
spray
glue stuff. So we were inside. Right. And we're doing something with the headliner and the way the sail panels needed to be. Right. So both of us are in there. We both got spray guns. We're doing stuff. And we've been in there for a little while and we're tucking stuff around. I can't remember what we were doing. Anyway, we're in there for a while. And I told him, I was like, oh, man, shit, I'm starting to get a little fucked up. Whatever. He looks at me, he's like, just let it take you where it wants to take you. And I was like, oh, damn, you're fucked up too. And, yeah, so I just, we stayed another 3 hours in there and finished it all up. But that interior glue, that special yellow spray, that stuff, that's a good trip.
Yeah, I had a guy that I worked with at the lumber yard who was like a little bit old to be working at the lumber yard, and he was talking, he used to be a body journeyman and all this stuff. It's like, so what are you doing working for $7 an hour at this lumber yard? He's like, I cannot be around the chemicals anymore. Like it causes like a nervous system issue with him. He like, so he had to completely get away from it. And I think working with him and let me know that stuff early on was like, you can end up with some type of neurological issues from this. I don't know what exactly he was working
100%,
with.
100%, dude.
We never had no problem with model cars, though.
No.
But testers. Testers glue.
We had a body guy here. He's old school body guy. Came out of a body shop. Was, you know, probably 40 plus years in a body shop.
Oh.
And, and he's, like, the guy would do great work, but, I mean, he was, like, literally, not even exaggerating, his hands were like this all the time. And he would talk to you and he would touch things. And then, you know, he could calm it down when he was like working. But twice a day, 2-3 times a day, you know, he'd walk into the mixing room and just pump fucking lacquer thinner on his hands and a rag soaking wet with lacquer thinner.
Washing
he'd come
his
up
hands.
To me and talking to me and he's like wiping, you know, his hands down with lacquer thinner. And then he'd get done and then it goes back into the like.
What the hell?
And I'm like, where the fuck do you think it's like? I would not recommend doing that.
Maybe it's like alcohol. Like he needs it to like slow it down. You know,
I don't
like
know.
Yeah. Get a little squirt.
Yeah. Gotta get right.
You should see when he's not doing that.
Without the lag.
A little hair of the devil.
Yeah, being around chemicals is gnarly.
It's bad news. You gotta protect yourself from that shit.
Yeah, so, and when you're younger, you're like, I'm not gonna live that long, or I'm gonna live forever. Like it's not. I'm only doing this once, and like that project showed me that no, it takes one time.
Yeah. Oh, it does.
I remember being 20, 21, 22, doing all this kinds of stupid shit and always being like, if I make it to 50, I'll be doing something, right? And now I'll be 46 at the end of the year. And I'm always like,
oh, you're making
shit. I hope I got a couple more years past 50. I mean, that may not a lot, but
know,
a few more.
You're not ready.
Where did the GTA go ahead?
AC.
Up or down?
Down.
You're cold?
It's flat.
Turn the AC down. I'm hot.
Oh,
okay. Oh, so you mean turn it up and make it colder?
You want it colder?
Yeah, thank you.
Temperature down, right. Fan volume.
I'm freezing.
Are you flannel?
Well, you're right by the.
Yeah, I'm freezing.
We got to switch seats. I run hot.
We could
1 degree. Thanks.
You one
Who
degree.
Are you, my fucking wife?
You could also try growing a pair.
Damn, it's. I have, but they're sweaty.
Where did the GTA come from?
I had always wanted one. I don't know why. I wanted a white one. I wanted a black one. They're just like such cool cars. They're so menacing, and like no one was doing anything with them.
Fucking LSA in there, huh?
Yeah. And so it was between this and I think of like late 80s, like Ford LTD. I wanted like the Men in Black car or this thing.
That's two completely different.
I mean, the GTA was not fast by any means. And I don't think I knew what I was going to do with it when I first got it. I just loved the louvers. I loved the dash. I loved the taillights on that thing. Everything about it was so sick. The black and the gold. And that thing popped up on eBay and I was like, oh, this is a good deal. And it was. I think I got that car for its original paint and 120,000 miles. Like, it was high on the mileage side, but this guy kept it inside. It was like $6,500, and I drove that thing home. I was like, I'll come get it tomorrow. And I think I had that thing for not but a couple of months and just completely had torn into it.
Dude, who's doing all that fucking badass work, that whole intake system and shit?
That was my buddy Joey. He had an off-road shop, and he was kind of offered to do that. And it was kind of my idea hey, can we get these like front hood vents to actually work? He whipped that up. And it took a couple times. Yeah. People love that thing. And that intake kind of makes that car. That's why I kept the supercharger is because that intake was so much work and looks so cool. But yeah, he did a great job on that. That's like definitely when it's all painted and stuff, there's like a shot when everything was nice and
there you go, top right.
Other top right. Other right.
Yeah. otherwise the supercharged engine for this thing was the absolute worst choice ever.
Really?
In
LSAs, you can make some fucking good power.
You can make that power NA though now, you know, it's
I don't know. We got
But you're racing this thing, right? Or wanting to race
it? Okay. That's the problem. Is like
it's never where you want it to be.
Intake air temps.
IATs have always been ambient with this car. It's always just the heat soak issue and the radiator could not keep it cool. It's a bottom feeder car. We were not getting airflow. I was not getting airflow. Opened up the front, was still not getting airflow. And that engine was just cooking everything. Really? And then had to go with, I mean, that's what caused this whole intake thing because that thing comes off at a 45. You couldn't just run like a 90 tube. And then you end up with all this other stuff, the intercooler box, the intercooler pump, the intercooler that you can't see that's all buried in there. So you're just taking up all this space for that supercharger to make like 640 wheel horsepower when you could do it NA and just the heat on the track is with this thing.
Track and stuff when you're like boosting.
You got to understand he comes from a serious hardcore track background.
Yeah. Yep, you guys are big Miata guys, aren't you?
He is.
Yeah.
Best car ever.
A fucking mellow yellow theme Miata.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's pretty sick.
We bag on Phil on the Miata thing. After watching all your videos, we were just talking about this weekend. We went to a little cars and coffee thing and whatever. We were talking about like watching these videos when there's 40 fucking cars, you know, three wide. It looks like fucking a lot of fun.
So like I didn't know what I was doing with if you go back two videos, there was my crash from last weekend. Or I think it's just that. Yeah, here's it. Here it is.
Did you say lost skill?
Yeah, because it's like just poking fun at the previous video because there's. because I did recover it. But
pushing a little bit there.
I stepped out, and I'm like...
oh.
So I was live streaming the race and put that phone mount too close to my wheel, so I wasn't able to, like... You'll see when I'm going in to make this right turn, I have to, like, grip the wheel like that. Yeah. So, like, when it... Well, you guys got some ghosts?
just lost a cartel boot.
Yeah. Yeah, so I wasn't able to, like, grip it when it like stepped out, so that definitely contributed to it. But this is my first crash in this thing in like 2 years of racing, so not doing too bad. Shit. But that, like, going from the GTA, going I want to go do track stuff, and build that car to be a track car, never having done it before, just having a couple of friends with like newer Camaro doing it and be like, I want something cool and unique because that's just the thing to do. And then you start going to these events and you work your way up through the run groups and you end up at group five and you're kind of out there just going up against yourself trying to get PBs and you're like, okay, this is fun, I guess. And then you go race spec Miata and you're going, it doesn't matter. Your times don't matter anymore unless you're just out there for qualifying. But you're racing wheel to wheel with 40 cars or 30 cars and that just takes over. And then the no mechanical sympathy of the car, like you don't care if somebody hits you. It's like, oh, that was cool. Like, you know, these other cars, even if I just put the GTA into the runoffs and like,
yeah,
fill my oil cooler up with rocks, like that sucks.
Expensive.
You know, like, or like I wipe a fender out on that car. I don't think I've crashed it, but, or like something fell off the trailer and hit the bumper. It's like, damn it. Like something falls off the trailer and hits me out. I'm like, who cares? Like, I love to drive. That's what I found out, is I just love to go out there and drive. I love the cars, but I love to drive, you know, because spent so much time working on them that in this car you can actually just drive and drive and drive and
that
drive.
Makes a lot of sense. I mean, I can see that, of where the drive and the always getting better on this corner of because you watch them on the start, you know, and it's just, I mean, a hum of bees.
Yes.
And they're like dead equal. Yeah. Right. Until the first turn, and then it starts to sort of spread out. And then as you start getting through turns, you're like, oh, that guy's picking up speed there. He's good there.
Yeah.
He's going to lose a little there.
Yeah.
So from a driver standpoint, that's where I think that you know, honestly, because of your driving skill, I'd like to watch. I wouldn't want to ride with you.
Have you been spec Miata before?
I have not.
We've got an alternate
theory.
He's
more of a street racer and like a weekend warrior.
Oh, yeah? Like autocross? Like...
Did a lot of autocross back in the day. Or
cars and coffee. Like,
I do a lot of Mustangs, leaving cars and coffee.
Yeah, okay. That's pretty hard to do in a Miata. Yeah.
This is a pretty solid underhanded approach to try to get me to get in a Miata, so then you can then turn that around. And
dude, I mean, for all of the stuff, you have a Miata.
I was gifted a Miata.
But you have it. It's yours.
Right.
It's a great car.
We created this.
It's okay. You're in the safe space right now.
I have a lot more respect for you after owning or knowing that you're a Miata.
If I had to get rid of everything, I would keep the spec Miata.
No shit.
It'd be the one car I would keep.
All right, we're going to save the best.
Everyone's like, okay, you can leave. You can leave now.
We're saving the best car for last, but I want to know about this video. You just did this Virginia Hill climb,
okay,
right?
Okay, so this is like another like event that is so cool.
You're going fast.
Was this sped up?
No. That clip, I think I sped up 10%.
The YouTube video or whatever?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah, we're ripping. We're doing like 130. Like the GT2 is probably doing 140 something up there. Damn. Like it is, like this is such a rare event that you can just take like a bone stock street bike production car. Like you don't need a cage and they'll let you run it full tilt up a 5 mile hill.
The video's nuts.
How much faster is the Miata than the GT2?
It's a GT3.
GT3 RS. I almost brought the Miata to this event this year, but then brought this as like a backup car because it's at elevation and it eats horsepower up. Here's a couple of like full speed runs that are not sped up. But yeah, this thing's jamming up here. This car was 18 seconds faster than the GTA was, and it has 150 less horsepower.
Yeah, this German's got that whole like engineering and handling thing figured out.
But you can just, it just works so well. And I've had issues with the GTA because of that supercharged engine. I've had belt issues, pulley issues. I've had overheating issues. I've had oil spinning issues. I've had fuel venting issues that have always kept this event kind of like, well, almost that, painful.
There's that whole like ill handling suspension thing too on those cars.
They're not that great. Yeah, like the solid rear axle, like, and that's the thing I've with the C4 and with this thing and a couple other, and the Miata, it's like if it doesn't have IRS, like you have no, like it's just not going to be competitive.
Yeah,
like
I think the GTA needs a refresh with the chassis.
Yeah,
100%.
Yeah, I just don't want to redo the whole thing again. I might have to do a new one. Yeah. Yeah, I almost want to do, because I want to do a third gen Camaro, because those actually have bigger fender flares. I was always wondering, and like, you might have to measure it, but like, look at them. They're like more squared off. Like the Firebird is like more like a subtle like curve, and everyone fits 315s on those things squared, no problem. And I'm like, I had to struggle to fit 315s, and they were like more, they were the Falcon 315s. They're earlier 615K pluses, and those are closer to a 295. And so when I actually got a 315, there's no way it would fit. I had to like channel that, or like notch the chassis on where it steered in the back to get those
315s. Yeah, do a replica of Dale Sr.'s IROC car.
Oh,
like the race champions car.
Just get the real one. Get the real IROC car. Those things are for sale. I think they come up every now and again.
All right. It brings us to the best, right? The best for last.
This is one you've been geeking
about. I've got to know, coming from the South, you know, born and raised, and spent most of my time in Alabama. My wife and her dad actually in Hueytown, where Bobby Allison is, like, shop, race go-karts together. Like, so how the hell does this happen?
So this just happens, like, too much time on the internet, and you see it's it for sale, and you're like, hey, can we make this happen? Like, yeah, it's only, like, $55,000, like, what are we going to do? Oh, we can do all this content. That's the nice thing about having the Instagram. Oh, yeah. And having the brand be in the automotive space is that you can justify these ridiculous things. Like, what other, like, business can you, like, really do that? You guys can do it, but, like, a sunglass brand, you can, like, how are you going to do this for a tax write-off? It's like, or, like, how are you going to do that? It's like, well, we absolutely can. Like, we're doing these events. Like, we're using this stuff all the time. We get to bring it to... Anyways, so this thing pops up on Canepa's website. And it's like, yeah, let's go check it out. And it's like, I knew once we went and looked at it that we were going to buy it. And I was just like, bought it and didn't realize how much of a race car it really was. Like, every time I drove it on the street, it like broke. And so doing more content with it on the street wasn't as easy. So then just started kind of tracking it and bringing it to events. But I did take it to a Cars and Coffee last year and drove it down the freeway.
You just stuffed some plates on it.
No, I just took it.
Fucking Bobby Allison. You can drive that fucker wherever you want to.
Exactly.
Yeah, in California, I don't know if that translates.
It would take the right person to. I mean, it was either we weren't going to see anybody, or we were going to get it taken away forever. And I'm like, I'm willing to risk it. Let's just say, we're going to like a charity, like car event for like sick kids, you know? Like,
absolutely. That's what I was going to say, dude.
But luckily made it without any issues. People were stoked on it. But it was hard to like find the history on this car. Cause of course, like it gets sold saying it was this and it was that. And it's from the year that Bobby crashed and didn't get to race the whole year. So I actually had gotten photos, and it's signed by Bobby on the dash. I didn't buy it from the previous owner. It was kind of on a consignment deal. So I had a bunch of photos of it and sent it to Bobby's address, because I think it was just on their website. And then I get a phone call from Alabama like a couple of weeks later, and Bobby Allison called me, and I shot the shit with him for like an hour and a half, and he was telling me all this stuff, like, yeah, I wouldn't have signed it unless it was mine. It looks like my car. We would have used it for this, but I don't remember a whole lot from this year. And it's definitely not the Daytona 500 winning car, but it could have been a car that would have been like his road course car for the year, because the front end is kind of special. And then I heard it went, and then the history kind of gets dodgy after that. And then Stavola Brothers like kind of disbanded after that. But then it went from like Miller to like Snickers, and I think maybe Bobby Hillen or Dick Trickle might have driven it. But it's just, there's just nothing really like verified on it after that point. And since we can't find a chassis number, I don't know if it got painted over or tube or something got replaced. But there's been a lot of people that have chimed in on these style posts that like, hey, my dad used to have this. I have a picture of it on coming out of Florida. Like when I first started this Heatwave Racing page, it was just all this car. This guy goes, yeah, that we shipped it to California and here it is getting loaded onto a trailer in like 99 or 2000. I was like, yeah, so it was there. That looks like it. Because I've looked at all the pictures of them. Like the wings are different. The front ends are different. But they would have like re-clipped these cars.
It's fucked with those things every single weekend.
You don't have a tattoo of that on you anywhere?
No. I'd have a Davey tattoo. But Bobby was just a little bit before my era as far as watching and being an enthusiast. But I know from being into NASCAR, I know the lineage and I know the history. I know the cars from going back. But Davey was, you know, his son Davey was the shit. That was my shit.
Yeah, I mean, it was a great era, and yeah, it was just the perfect car to get because the livery was super good. And
oh, I mean, MGD.
Yeah. Miller High. It's High Life.
High Life.
But,
didn't influence your drinking.
No. I saw the first picture social media wise, this is probably a couple years ago, and I saw it and I was like, oh, that's cool that y'all did a livery. And then I started looking, I was like, oh. And then I had to do digging. I spent probably 30 minutes of going back through and I'm like, that's the fucking car. How the fuck do these dudes out there get this? And then I start like, oh, he's got to be an enthusiast. Like, there's no way, like, you're just, fucking around with this shit. So then, oh, yeah. I mean, it's at the end of the day, it's just knowing enough to know to buy that,
Yeah. Yeah. And the problem is now it's like the same thing with the track day stuff is that you start bringing it out and you get comfortable with the car and you start pushing it. And I've had a couple of instances where I've spun it or I've put it off and you're just like, and you're doing damage to it when it does. You're like cracking like a valance on it or something, and there's a lot of Bondo on that car, to get him to be that smooth, Yeah. So it's like, and then you go out and drive and everyone wants to drive with you. They kind of start, you're like, okay, I want to chase someone. And everyone's like, oh, I want to be behind this. I want to be next to it. And so I got to drive it with one other car once at Willow Springs. And I was like, okay, I get it. Like you can actually, cause you can't hear any other car in that thing. But then when you can hear the other car, you can see them in your mirror, you're chasing them. You're like, okay, this is super cool. So it's actually sat for, I want to say over a year besides that Cars and Coffee event. And it just kind of became like a one-to-one like die cast. And I still find myself like wanting to get more of them, but I'm like, what am I going to do with this? Like get one for my friend to drive, which we've already done with the Miatas. We have three Miatas. So we let the guys at work drive them.
But you're obviously very successful if you can afford three Miatas. Yeah.
But then they just had this Velocity Invitational event where they got like 20 cars of the historic cars. So we actually got to go race it finally. And those guys hadn't raced in quite a while. So they're hoping to get the band back together of this Historic Stock Car Association.
That'd be cool.
And that was super cool. We still finished both races under caution, but it was badass to have that car out again and be running with a bunch of, cool. I think there was 18 cars out there. It was like 1978 to 2013. The newer cars obviously dusted us and I had a couple of issues. The brakes went out on it and stuff, but yeah, it was super cool to get to run that again. I just ran it again.
JR
2 weeks ago.
Hildebrand he was out there racing.
Yeah, he was dusting us. He had a motor issue. Otherwise he for sure would have gotten first. But I think a lot of these cars hadn't run in so long that even though they were prepped, the other stuff was kind of taking a shit on them, because these guys were doing like San Jose Grand Prix, Long Beach Grand Prix. They were doing like 8-9 events a year, and then there was nothing. And you can go run it in like maybe like an SCCA class with some like modern like fiberglass cars, but there's only like one or two cars. It's not really worth it to go smash on these things for that. And they're not really competitive with a newer like 2013, 14 Camaro or something like that.
What's next on the list? Itch's got a scratch for the car wise.
I just got a lot of shit recently. I got that Porsche, that GT3, and that was an itch I wanted to scratch, but I didn't want to get that car because I was like, this is going to ruin everything else, and I'm like, I'm not a Porsche guy. I'm like the least Porsche guy imaginable. At least I think I'll keep telling myself that. But these GT3s are just heard such good things about them. GT3 RS and GT2 RS. And I just love being able to drive. When I go to the track, I don't want to deal with problems. And I love that car for what it is. And I love that I have no mechanical sympathy with that car either. I treat it just like the Miata. Like, regardless of how much it costs, like, I'm going to beat the shit out of it. I probably won't go rub door to door with another GT3. Right. But
get expensive.
Yeah. But that I just got. And then I just got that K100 hauler Aerodyne hauler,
yeah,
which was a huge mistake. But that thing is so sick.
What year is it?
It is a 1996.
Oh, yeah. It's a fucking mechanical disaster. Yeah. Probably,
it's actually, it's been really well taken care of. This is a bad video of this is when they took the package to somebody. If you scroll down, there's a, it could go a little bit further. There it is, just kind of cruising up.
Those are bitching.
It is so cool. And
is that
I wanted
a Canepa built?
Yeah, it's a concept transporter. I don't know if it's like got the Canepa signature to it, but it's got some of the aero on like the fuel tanks and stuff. But it's like, it's done so to the nines for 96. Or maybe I think it's a 92. That's my dumbass jumping out of it.
Look at the first four comments. You got Nick Eisenhower. Yeah, yeah. You got Morgan Clark. Yeah. Right? You got Casey Hylitz and Dynamic Weapons.
Yeah. I mean, that I've wanted a cab over for so long for absolutely no reason.
No, reason is that they're badass.
Yeah, they're like so impractical now. There's so many better things to get, and like, but this thing is so badass. They ain't making any more of them, you know. Like, and it's the Aerodyne, so it's got a sleeper in the back. I took this thing to the hill climb, put my 6-month-old in a car seat, and all the way over there in the air seat, and made my lady and my 4-year-old cruise in the back in the sleepers. And this thing's got like a cool lounge in it with like a VHS. They didn't go back there with a pass through, and I can carry two cars in it. So it's like the perfect like track day getaway. It's got onboard race fuel. It's got a whole, like, it's got so much stuff. It's got like jacks, and it's got a canopy. It's got, compartment underneath is like filled with, somebody's got onboard air. It's got air hookups everywhere in it.
Perfect for the zombie apocalypse, but if nothing else.
It's mechanically sound. I mean, you jump in that thing and just roll it.
I mean, it's got a old like big cam Cummins in it, and like they're archaic as hell. And it works. Like the tires are new. It's been well taken care of. Like it did a couple of weird things to me. Like it had a fan clutch that was missing half the friction discs in it, but we sent it anyways. It does about 38 miles an hour up like a grade, but it is so cool. It takes forever to get anywhere in it, and you can't stop like anywhere besides a truck stop. It's so impractical, but it's so cool. I love this.
You keep talking about Canepa's place. How is that place not nuts?
Yeah, you guys were just there recently, right?
Yeah, we did a podcast. Bruce is a wild guy. Yeah, man.
It is just like you would never really think that some place like that could exist.
Right.
Yeah. And then everywhere you look, it's like, that's $1 million. That's $3 million. Like that, I don't even know has a price to it. Like, for that like high end, like race car, like ultra rich, like Porsche world, it is just so cool. And there's just so much cool shit sitting in there, and the work that they do there, and like the amount of expertise and like specialty that they have to work on that vintage. Like, it's not just Porsches, but like the vintage Porsche and race car stuff is just, it's just crazy to keep that stuff true. And then I think they're the only place that can modify a classic car and have it worth more than what it was. Like a modify of supercar, the 959s. Make the SCs, like, and make it worth like way more.
When he told me they bring in like the project cars, like $1 to $2 million.
Yeah, and then down to nothing.
I'm not a major Porsche guy, so I didn't really know. I mean, I know a little bit about him, but it's that whole operation's crazy. I mean, that dude Bruce is like he's a hustler. He's the guy that makes it all fucking happen.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
You're like, we got there early to do that podcast, and he is just on the fucking shop floor. Like, he's the guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's impressive.
That trip goes down in history is one of the funnest. And
pretty solid car week.
Canepa's place is crazy. You should see Bruce Meyer's place. Really? I know they fuck with each other. That's why I brought it up, because they fuck with each other. Bruce Meyer's place down in L.A., down in Beverly Hills. Holy shit.
Really?
No, not on the scale. And like you said, the race car stuff, but you're just like,
The location is
amazing, and then it's the, like, it's two different things, but Bruce Meyer says, like, he's got to meet criteria. Like, this car has to have a story, and it has to be one of one, and it has to be beautiful.
Yeah.
If it doesn't hit those three things, like, it could be one of one, but it's ugly. I don't want it. Yeah. Right? It could be...
Just the best looking, like, most tasteful car collection.
Yeah.
Just everything.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Hot rods to vintage race cars, yeah. Porsche stuff.
I'm just doing this to fuck with Canepa because yeah. he knows that he's going to live.
I love Canepa stuff because it's all race car, and I'm a huge, like function equals form, and, like, this stuff has to, like, work. And I know you guys are, like, big on that, too. And that's, like, the Chevelle is, like, a lot of, like, form first and, like, has a lot of race car parts on it, and that's why I'm, like, kind of, like, that went in a direction I didn't want, but, like, I love what race cars are because they only look the way they do because they have to, yeah, and yes. they look so cool, and all the parts on them are so impractical for the street, but that's what makes us want to do it for the street, you know, like yeah. all that stuff they do, that's where we take our inspiration and try and blend it. Yeah, I love the race car stuff. I love it so much. He was selling some that Ford Motocraft Fox Body, that vintage IMSA car.
Yeah.
And I just, like, sent Canepa an email. I'm like, oh, how much is this? And then it's like, oh, what's your phone? And then Bruce calls me. I'm like, Bruce, you don't have to call me for these things. And he gives me the whole story on it. And he goes, it's $750,000. I'm like, yeah, if you know it's that much, you just don't call me. Just say you can't afford it. Like, or just say you don't want it, you know? Like, I was like, you know what the last car I bought from you, how much that was? Like, I am not buying a $750,000, like, vintage IMSA car. I'm, like, not even going to be able to drive that, you know? Like, he's like, oh, yeah, like, Jim Farley was saying he wanted to buy it, and he said he wanted to put it on his Christmas list. Like, yeah, he was saying someone from Ford. I don't know if it was Jim Farley, but he was, I'm just like, dude, you don't have to, like, waste your time calling me. Just hit me with a text going, it's $750,000. Like, and I'll just say no.
Give me, like, the four money emojis.
Yeah.
It's a lot.
Yeah. So many.
It's emojis. A shit ton.
Yeah. I think I feel lucky that I got out of there with, like, a sub 100K car.
Yeah.
Incredible place. So, yeah. Man, incredible guy. Incredible place. That's just unbelievable.
Yeah. And he's a hell of a driver, too. He's, like, been into it. Like, all those cars have a ton of hit. And just the way he can talk about all that stuff and the cars there, like, in the museum and everything. You're like, damn, this was, like, really the one. Like, this is, like, the history car. Yeah. They got, like, that six-wheel, like, Indy car and stuff. I don't know if that was. The F1 car, sorry.
Yeah. Earnhardt's Wrangler.
Yeah.
G-body and
that stuff.
Yeah,
stuff. Oh, the Pearson. Yeah, that. Everything. I'm gonna have to take a pause. I gotta use the restroom.
Okay.
I apologize, but it's gonna.
Tongue tied him there.
Oh, is it distracting you? Oh, we'll take a break.
Let's take a break. Yeah, like, I know, like, the thing is, the Porsche has no personality, you know. So it's like,
yeah,
it's anyone can go buy one. It's super cool, but, like,
it's like a cheat code.
No one cares. You pull up, like, people see it and go, oh, that's sick. Like, people that aren't really into cars really like that thing, that just go, I know that's an expensive car, that's a cool car, but like the GTA, like, gets people looking at the Chevelle, yeah. gets people, like, interested in it. Like, those cars have personality, and the you can never get that with a bone stock GT3 RS. Like, I can go have the most fun in that car in the world. Bless you.
Thank you. That's it.
That's a lot.
Yeah, so there's, like, the balance there, you know, like, it's hard to get the best of both worlds on anything. And that's kind of where the GTA went. It was, like, trying to be this best, like, a car that was good for the street, but also could go tear shit up at the track. And then you kind of make this thing that's a blend between the two, and it really ends up being not good for either one. As the scale slides, it starts towards track, it starts to suck for the street. As soon as you put that racing fixed back bucket in it, like, in 5 points, like, it starts to suck for the street, and, like, the sequential and stuff starts to suck for the street. Like,
yeah, you know? The sequential's not great.
It's, like,
it's awesome for banging.
Yeah,
it sounds cool. We did like a dog box Richmond 5-speed in a car, Camaro, years ago, and ripped it around the street. It's horrible. Fucking terrible.
Yeah,
on the
little
street.
3-inch
yeah.
clutches.
Yeah.
But fucking it sounds good. Badass.
Yeah, you just get like rev. You get those snappy revs and everything, and the but you can't get that unless you do that for the street. So you want to have that race car sound going to cars and coffee or unloading from the truck.
It's like an idiot. You're either stalling it or you're doing a nasty burnout.
I don't think it's not fair to say for the street it sucks. It's the street's fine. It's the traffic and, like, stoplights.
Yeah.
If it wasn't for that, you could take it on the street.
Traffic. A stoplight's fine because as long as you can just like sidestep the clutch and go.
You get after it. Yeah. It's just the other cars and the traffic laws.
Yeah.
Speed limit kind of
the
fucks.
Speed limit sucks.
Bad. Yeah. And then you just can't, if you just can't use it on the street or it just becomes so obnoxiously loud that it's not pleasant to drive in, you know, like as I'm getting a little older, actually, I kind of got out of the open header stuff when I was like right out of high school. You're like, oh, this is cool. Everyone's pissed off. Like, it's badass. And then after a bit, you're like, oh, yeah, it sounds like shit.
You start making a house payment and you have neighbors and all that.
And you're like, oh, I don't want to be that guy, you know? Like,
it's funny how you grew up like that.
Yeah.
Like, we get a lot of customers that want to put like exhaust cutouts and stuff, you know, older guys or guys, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s. And you don't realize that, like we did them on a, like an LT5, fucking brand new supercharged 750 horse LT5 on a Camaro. It sounds like shit.
It does.
It sounds horrible. Like they don't have, you could take a 350 horse small block Chevy and it sounds nasty.
Yeah. Sounds like a fucking top fuel car.
Yeah. Right.
56 gasser makes.
Yeah. It's a 327. Yeah. The thing's probably 320 horsepower.
Yeah.
And it sounds like, you know, if fucking John Force is pulling up to the line.
Yeah.
But yeah.
You know, these modern motor, they just don't sound great. I mean, unless you got some nasty cam or like something, they're just, they don't do it.
Yeah. You got to like bump up the compression seriously or something. And they don't need it. They just don't sound tuned. Like, you know, there's, and as you get more into it, and I'm sure you guys find it's like you have your taste, you need, it refines, you know, like, and you can appreciate that, oh, it still sounds great, but it's not like loud, you know, it's not obnoxious, you know, like, and that's a hard thing to get because you start to dial back these things and you have to pick the right exhaust. You can't just go open header. You have to build it right. You have to build the headers right. You have to build all that stuff like proper for it to actually sound good. And so you like appreciate that stuff.
You appreciate it and then you get a feel for like, I feel like you learn your customer more. You know, like most of the cars we do now, like I can't tell you how many C10s and stuff we've done that we'll put four mufflers and a resonator to keep it like so civilized.
Yeah.
But we just did a twin turbo 57 Chevy Bel Air. The car makes like 1300 horse. And the guy, he's a young guy. He's probably in his like early 30s. Yeah. Fuck the mufflers. Like turbos are mufflers.
Yeah.
And it's, I mean, it's not obnoxious, but holy shit, does it sound good?
Yeah. Right.
And he loves it. Yeah. We love it. It's like there's a time and a place for it.
Yeah.
Well, that's where I think it goes to, like to your point, talking about the GTA where you tried to make it all things. That's where shops, customers, builds get to a bad spot when you're trying to make something all things, right? Yeah. Because when you try to make something all things, you fall short at all things.
Yes.
If you want to make a race car, make a race car. Make it a badass fucking race car and just know that it's not going to be fun on the street. It might be street legal, but it's not going to be fun on the street. And it might, the worse it is on the street, probably the better it is on the track, right? Yeah. And the better it is on the track, the worse it's going to be on the street. Same thing goes with the like integration of technology, right? Especially in our world on building cars, people want to like, I want 4-digit horsepower to the tires, right? I got to have 1,000 horsepower, right? And I want heated seats, I want powered seats, I want navigation, and I want all this stuff, and I want the air to blow cold, and I want this, and I want that, and I want that.
Apple CarPlay.
And I want all this kind of stuff. Well, you start trying to pack all that stuff into it, and that's fine. You can get some of these things to work, but trying to make it the fastest, right, handle the most, be the quietest and all that stuff, you're starting to fight yourself, right? Yeah. If you want to say, I want to build the nicest cruiser, right? I want to build the best riding, most comfortable, quietest, you know, lowest NVH, you know, thing like that. Well, you're probably not going to handle the best, right? And it's probably not going to have the most horsepower. But just understand it's going to do that. We talk about that on, like, cars we're wanting to purchase or, like, daily drivers and stuff. There comes a time to, you love the square body. You love the Legends truck, right? And then there's times you like dropping in your Denali, right? And you're like, it's nice sometimes just to jump in and you become accustomed to some of these. When you're driving on a longer trip
still
and stuff like that.
Still trying to figure out when that truck's
maybe that truck's a bad example. Yeah. But there's times where you're like, I just want to jump in something. I love how my, you know, my Android picks up or the, you know, car.
It's an
CarPlay.
iPhone. It's an iPhone.
Yeah. Right. That's a fucking insult.
Mine isn't.
You're an Android.
You know, and some of those things that, you know, you hit the little button on the thing and your garage door opens and stuff that you become accustomed to. But then there's other times where you like, I just like the rawness. The problem is when people try to pack all the things that they like about the raw analog car and all the technology and all that stuff into one.
You lose all of it.
You lose all of it.
Yeah. Yeah. We've got, I mean.
Just know that it can't be all things.
Yeah. We've got two, like, I think pretty educated customers that have built really good cars. Like, you got Chris, who did the Camaro and now the Nova.
Yeah.
And then you've got Bobby, that Bobby knows a fucking cruiser, right? So it's just fucking 430 horse LS 4L60. And that Nova, that 63 Nova that Chris did, it was, you know, fuck the power windows. You can roll them up. Like, I'm probably going to leave them down. That car has absolutely no frills,
right.
But it's a 2.9 Whipple. It's, you know, I mean, on E85, it'd make probably close to 1,000. On pump gas, it's 850. That is the fucking nastiest car, the best street car that you could ask for. Like, are you going to take it on a road course? No.
Right.
Like, could it do it? Yeah, you can go out and do a track day. That's not what it's for. But you that, like,
burn some fucking tires up stoplight to stoplight.
Yeah. But to your point, like, you're talking about some of that comes with maturity, right? And then in the business side of things, on, like, you know, from a shop or a car builder, it comes the knowing the expectation, and the customer is the same thing, is be realistic with the expectation and just know, I want a lot of different things. You might have to build multiple cars because you're not going to scratch all those itches with one car. You know that.
Yeah.
You can't build the Lincoln Cruiser that's with white walls. It's badass. That's also going to spec Miata race. It's also going to have 1,200 horsepower. Yeah. That's also going to do GT3 RS shit.
Right. Yeah. You cannot do it. I mean, you got your Venn diagrams here, and you get these big eyes. I think when you start these projects, like, you can do like maybe two things good, and it just sometimes they're too far apart to like bring together. They don't overlap as well as you think they do, and then the higher the horsepower, like even for the street, I might get some hate for this. We got to normalize like 600 horsepower, 700 horsepower for the street. Like anything,
just do smaller tires. Smaller tires and 600 horsepower is fast.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I'm with you, dude. I've got, me and Phil are doing a 70 Trans Am, the one sitting right down here. And my knowledge of building fuck tons of cars, it's like 670 horse.
Yeah.
NA LS7, because that's, it's probably the most fun you can have in a street car with a 6-speed.
Yeah. I mean, it 1,000 horsepower is just, you can't put it down. You can't even put down 600-700 horsepower on street tires. Like,
you'd be surprised though. Like, it's coming a long way.
Okay.
Like,
you can put down 1,000 horsepower with the right stuff, but that's, that car becomes something else. But that car becomes, well,
dangerous.
Some, well, yeah, 100% dangerous.
Well, you can't use it all.
Yeah.
You know,
in
like
third gear, you can use it.
All right. You get like doing like roll racing on the street with it?
Yeah, okay, first gear is completely not usable.
I guess I'm not doing that. So
you're just trying to just get after it.
I'm more like driving around town or like hitting the back roads. We got a lot of curves out there in the mountains and stuff like that. So like
1,000 horsepower is not good for curves.
Like the last thing you want, like there's a certain point when you're gripping where more horsepower slows you down, you know, when you're trying to bring it in together and trying to control it. So I guess I'm talking about a different thing. If you're actually going and roll racing or doing, you know, going and drag racing and stuff and putting those real sticky tires on your car where you can actually use it, then yeah, sure. But then you are kind of racing, you're kind of going to the racing, but for the most part, for a street car, like that, you're putting like a 200 treadwear tire on or something like that. It's just like, or like, and it's like 18s, like low profile, like a 30 ratio. It's like good luck.
Yeah, we went like the opposite direction. We're 15 inch wheels.
Okay.
With an Avon race tire.
Okay.
675 horse.
Okay.
LS7.
Yeah.
And that's fun. Like because it's, you could just fucking rip that.
Yeah.
You can scare yourself. You can get a little bit loose. And
So you guys are doing a little bit different stuff out here. So I guess there's like, it's like regional, like of what suits what the person is doing.
Yeah.
Like,
and educating the customer too.
Yeah. Because again, you can go into something and think that, oh, I want it this way, but you don't know what it's really like. Because you have this picture in your head of what it's going to be like, but that's, sometimes those things don't blend together in real life as well as you think they will.
Yeah, you're 100% right.
Standard question time.
Hit it.
Best car movie.
Oh, for me, I don't know, probably Days of Thunder.
Yeah, I would have bet $1,000 that
was that. Okay. Yellow fucking.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
We just watched Days of Thunder at the house not too long ago.
It's so good. It definitely wasn't my first one. There's a lot of ones that like sparked like the wonder in me. I think early on, I think like, even like Batman and Back to the Future, where you're like, you see those cars become like heroes themselves, or almost stars of the movies themselves. Like, and as you're a young kid, that even like RoboCop, those Tauruses, those were sick. Yeah. You know, like I'm like,
RoboCop was good.
like, so that I think, you know, as a young kid growing up, like you see that stuff and you're like, oh, that's like grandma's Taurus, but like, that's the RoboCop car, you know, like, look, let's paint it gray.
And put some fucking,
put some side skirts on it. And
So I think there's a lot of that, that, that really shaped or like, you know, got me into cars, you know, but like, I would say like as a movie, I would like to go back to Cars, like Days of Thunder, but like it's a coming of age, and like the first Fast and Furious is good too. Like, you just being like, okay, this is a thing. You
did know? A lot for the industry.
Yeah. And that I bet it had some, and it was right around the time I got rid of the 70 Chevelle and got the 65. So I'm like, oh, I'm going to build this Root supercharged crazy car that can do wheelies.
You live your life 1/4 mile.
You live your life.
Yeah. And we were actually out there like street race. There was like some good street races out where we were at, when I was growing up. It was a huge scene. It was way before sideshows and stuff. So it was like a legit thing. And It was a ton of fun, and there was a huge scene like in the imports and the domestic stuff. So it was the real.
You mess thing. Around and jump on one of those imports back in the day like that. Yeah. You'd get more than you bargained for.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Josh was telling me about that. We went to this Cars and Coffee over the weekend, and there's some bitchin' exotics, and Josh wanders his way over to like a 93 Civic. It's got a turbo on it.
2.2 swap and a turbo and all stuff.
Like, this right here, this will blow your fucking mind right here.
I said, I didn't say bar none, it was the fastest thing. I'm just saying for like
dude,
power to weight ratio and having to be up on your game driving it. It's an experience. Rocket ship.
First thing on my mind, I'm like, dude, I'm just looking at it and it looks all I can see his torque steer.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, you're damn right.
All left and right. Yeah, left right. And right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some both guardrails.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, but it's no different than, you know, swapping sides on the backside. You know, it's just, you're fighting it. It's a different experience. Since you're similar age, little different question. I know a little bit picking up on how you grew up and stuff like that and similar age. What's the first movie you watched on Laserdisc?
I don't know, maybe, I don't even know, I would have had to go to somebody's house to watch Laserdisc. I didn't have that, but, so I can't even really say. I could, like, make something up, but I don't even know if it's true.
Fine. You don't know.
I can chime in on it.
I wasn't rich enough to have
Laserdisc. I didn't have Laserdisc either. Yeah. It was at my girlfriend's house, but mine was 7. So Brad Pitt 7.
That's, way far past, like, Laserdisc.
Yeah, I know.
It was in Alabama.
They were just getting them.
Yeah, we were just getting them. This was Georgia, actually.
We were late adopters, I think, to the Laserdisc. I remember when Dad went, we had a normal fucking tube TV forever.
Okay.
Then I remember going, and we got the fucking Mitsubishi rear projection.
Okay.
And I'm like, Dad has made it. Right. This is it. Holy
everybody
shit.
See this? We're rolling this out. Yeah.
I vividly remember this. He's buying a Laserdisc, right? And the guy's like, "Don't buy the Laserdisc. There's this DVD player, and this is going to be all the rage, right?" And he's like, "Yeah, fuck it. A CD, right?
A little bitty thing. I want a Laserdisc." I remember
this, right? So he buys the fucking Laserdisc, and we get it home. And then we had the Laserdiscs and stuff. So there were two Laserdiscs that stand out to me. One, Days of Thunder,
obviously,
because that was the first thing that went in the Laserdisc player.
It's surround sound.
To showcase.
It's a life changer.
The sound, right? And the other one, I see it sitting there. It's Flashdance.
Oh.
Do you remember Flashdance?
Yeah.
Well, I thought that was
Swayze?
Like. No, Flashdance was like, I forget who the star of it was, but she's wearing
Olivia Newton-John, right?
Yeah. And I thought it was like an Emmanuel type softcore Cinemax like action.
It's not that.
So it's no, it was a legitimate dance. Like
right, it's a fucking musical.
Major disappointment, but the cover would lead you to believe.
He said Emmanuel.
Yeah. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
A lot of people listen
in the belly button.
Yeah.
those movie covers were like storytelling in themselves back in the day. They don't do it like that anymore, you know?
Don't even get to see, you don't even get to touch anything. It's just like click. Oh, it's out. You know, let's watch this.
Yeah, well, they had all that like Drew Struzan artwork on the cover of those movies back in the day. Look at The Thing, like that's not even in the movie, you know?
Yeah.
Like, but that stuff is like so iconic. And when you're browsing the at Blockbuster and stuff like that, or the local video store, you see those covers.
Blockbuster was the place to be. Dude, the absolute place to be on Friday nights.
It dates me because, like, even I can remember going with my wife. Like, it doesn't feel like that long ago, and it was right.
It was a long time ago.
And we would go and, like, get fucking movies, and she'd be coming home. She'd get off work. What are you getting tonight, honey? Like,
it's something. I know we sound fucking old, and I'm sure this has been talked about 100 times, but there's something about, like, there was that, you know, you get off work, you know, you talk to, and we're like, hey, let's just do Blockbuster night, right? We're going to stop. What's going to get some, you go into Blockbuster and you always check like what's been returned, right? Like, oh, I'm going to try to see if we can get something new.
Kids will never understand.
Right. And then you go through and you find something, right? And you never leave with one movie. It's always two, right? You always get two movies because you're like, well, I don't really want to watch that, but maybe. And then it's like browse through a couple of candy, right? Something like that, Mike and Ike's or whatever. And you get stuff. And that was like, you look forward to that.
Yeah.
Like now it's just,
too easy. Too easy.
Pull up Netflix and
you didn't have to pay like the fine that I probably didn't return the movie on time on the family card. So
$100.
Yeah. Of course you didn't.
Yeah. Do you remember?
I ran out of gas.
Well, dude, there were stories about like the dude who didn't return a movie for like a long time.
Yeah.
You know, and it was basically like the family was about, they were going to declare bankruptcy.
It broke
them. The fines were like immeasurable.
Yeah. I think you even got like in trouble if you didn't rewind it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You get in trouble. Yeah. Be kind. Rewind.
Yeah.
I got a curveball to throw at you.
All right.
We do standard questions all the time, but something I've been thinking about because you dropped a lot of interesting things. Your first business, you started in the early 2000s, and then you had another business that started in like 2010, 2012. So I feel like you hit two businesses at very interesting times, right? You had one at like the kind of the beginning of the internet, and the second one was like kind of the beginning of like social media is starting.
Yes.
If you were going to start another business tomorrow, let's say you're going to start you're going to make shoes. You're going to start a shoe brand.
Yeah.
And you can either go back in time or you could go to the future. Good
question.
Where are you going to start that business? And are you going to start that in 2001? Are you going to start that in like current times? You've got all the access to social media, or you have no access to social media and very limited internet.
I think I would go back in time because I can activate, if I'm into it, I can activate in the space, and the forums were such a better way to connect with a community that you have posters that are known, and you know, like everything goes to the top, you know, like you have people that are, you know, that are on there that are vetted, that are saying like, yeah, this, I've dealt with this guy, he's good or whatever, you know, like, and you can build a rapport on there before starting a business or before starting something. You just don't have that anymore. It's like here today, here for, as I scroll past it, gone, like, and that's that, you know, like getting something started, and everyone is so immune to the marketing now. Yep. And they're so like kind of starting to get, of course there's always opportunities everywhere. But I think it's more difficult now with the way social media is, the way that everyone's trying to attack everyone. Everyone's targeting you with pixels, and you say something, or if you clicked on it once, now you're getting served ads for a while. And people are kind of standoffish towards that. And the whole influencer marketing thing, as soon as someone says, use my discount, it's like, all right, this is a shill now. Like, for me, I think I'm more turned off to that stuff than maybe the average person, but I know that if I'm turned off to it, then there is an element of it. So I would go back. If I got to keep my knowledge from now, yeah, I would go back. Right now it's tough to start something new. I don't even know. I had more ideas then of what I would do, and now just been kind of laser focused. I've been thinking about that recently. Like, what would I even do if I wasn't doing this right now? It's like back then I was like, I would do this, I would do that, I would do this, I would do that, you know?
Yeah.
Like, but now I'm like, kind of like, okay. Like,
I definitely feel like the average consumer is way more, either jaded or educated, mm-hmm. or their quality is the first thing. I look at it. I've got a daughter that's 20, and I've got a son that's about to turn 18 here next month, and my wife, and they're always, you know, my daughter's at college and they're talking about, you know, social media and they're looking at this, and you know, it's always about buying something, right? You know, this dress or this purse or this stuff. My son's always, you know, in it, you know, when we're like have family gatherings, they're always like, oh, did you see so-and-so? And my son will be like, yeah, but it's probably shit. Have you seen like the way they're, it's on everything. Or my daughter will say the same thing. Like, oh, I'm sure it's probably shit.
Yeah.
It's instantly like, because you've seen it in all these places and you're so used to it that the quality's got to be bad. So they're looking for the quality first throughout, trying to wade through that muck of the marketing. And my wife's the same way. Whereas a couple of years ago, it's like, you know, the friend group to be like, oh, I saw this on so-and-so, everybody's got to buy it.
Right.
And it's just because somebody said to buy it, they buy it. And quality second after they get it. But then that takes a while because they try to make excuses because they want to feel good about their purchase.
Yep.
So they're like, oh, it's kind of good. You know, it's not that bad for the price. Now it's completely opposite. It's like,
it's turned into like an infomercial. Like, you'd never buy that shit. It's on late night ads.
Exactly. Yeah.
My wife gives me shit regularly. I'm like, oh, check this thing out. I saw it. Oh, it's on Instagram. It's probably crap. You're not even on social media.
It's like, it's that stigma behind it, you know, like in.
Again, pendulum swing all the way back the other direction.
Yeah, might go to where no one trusts.
Advertising in newspapers.
Yeah. And the newspapers have to come back first, you know, like, yeah. But yeah, there's a distrust out there because they're like, you have things like Wish and Temu that have come up that sell things. That, oh, it's $2 for these pair of shoes, but I'm going to get it anyways. Oh yeah, they're crap. So then everything on Temu is crap, which it is. But then it's just like, oh, I bought something on Instagram and it was crap. Like, I don't buy anything on Instagram anymore. I don't buy anything on TikTok shop anymore. So
there's the fear that who you're buying from is buying it for $2 on Temu and selling it for $50.
Well, we run into knockoffs of our own product a lot. So our stuff is getting knocked off and they see it's available for $5 on there. And then you got people that don't know that it's knockoffs and you have people that go, I don't care if it's knockoffs. And
is that when you know you've made it?
I guess. When you're
knocking your shit off.
I guess. Yeah, I mean, luckily, we put a lot of trademark protection in place, and we do have a lot of design patents, so we're able to, like, stop a lot of this. It takes a little bit to stop it, to stop those floodgates once they're open, but we've been battling it for a few years, and they will copy the stuff so fast, and, like, and but it's, like, obviously shitty, but they've copied like almost everything and it just keeps popping up and we just keep taking it down. But we're so lucky because then they start to blur the logos or put something. But since, again, going back to, we've designed all of our own products from the ground up. So there's like the integrity there. So we have our ornamental design patents and we can take it down if it resembles it. So we're very fortunate that we were kind of forward thinking and doing that. But it's also a thing. It's like, if you get caught up just trying to like snuff out the fakes, like you, because there's so many of them, it's just going to keep happening. If you let your time can get consumed by that and stop kind of going towards the next, like they will eat you.
Yeah, they'll paralyze
you. They'll eat you alive. And so I try not to get too worked up about it. And it's like, yes, like I guess you've made it, but they're able to copy almost everything now. So I think that industry was like, the access to the internet, especially at this level with like Temu and TikTok shop, and they're able to get in front of people's eyes. These factories at an individual, like we've gone direct to consumer. Now it's factory to consumer through these channels that they can copy like anything, even if it's like, and that they can't kill 1,000 pinpricks. If they're copying Nikes, it's like a little bit easier to like get behind and stop them. It takes a bigger effort to do that too. But when they're copying smaller brands that are selling a couple thousand pieces, it's like, oh yeah, good luck trying. Luckily for us, we have our patents in place and we can stop them. So it becomes a kind of it's not worth it to copy them, or like, we'll go for the next lower quantity thing that's easier to copy. But yeah, I would try not to get too caught up on it. Cause I'm like, as soon as I don't have that next thing in the works, that's going to kind of make that last product not like kind of, oh, that was whatever. Then you got nothing. You know, you have to stay ahead of it. You have to always stay ahead of it because it's just going to happen. Once you get to that level, once they start copying, they're going to copy everything. So
do you have like a specific person that's their job to deal with that so it can keep your headspace clear? And
yeah, I think it gets brought to my attention. And then I have a person it's one of our customer service guys, and he's just combing like eBay and Temu and TikTok like a couple times a week. And just luckily these guys, the bigger companies like the Louis Vuittons of the world and Gucci, like have had these gigantic lawsuits against like eBay's for not policing that stuff. So these companies have to have these IP protection services suites like built in to like, where you can kind of submit in bulk. Cause if they're just ignoring you, then there's actual cases that can be levied against them. Like them from past, it's like, hey, you're not doing your job by keeping fakes off your marketplace. And, you know,
you can go after the marketplace.
VF Corp and blah, blah, blah versus this, like shows that you're negligent and not policing this, like, and they're opening themselves up to a way bigger problem unless they're kind of staying in front of that. And at least, you know, as long as you have your brand protection in order and you're getting there and getting registered, like, they'll take it down for you, but you got to have someone monitoring that. Otherwise, if you're not saying anything, they will get away with it.
Best piece of advice you've ever received?
Man. okay. Best piece of advice is it's not about the mistake you made. It's about the recovery, because the mistakes are always going to happen. You're always going to have these things where you fall short. But it's how you get yourself out of that, how you react to it, and how you continue to move forward, because it's inevitable. You're going to do stuff that you haven't tried before. You know, you're going to fall down, but it's like, do you sit there and give up, or like, do you try and figure it out, or how do you compose yourself when you're recovering? So that I always kind of sticks with me. It's like, I think it's just a golf piece of advice.
Because
you're never going to hit that perfect shot every time, you know? Yeah. How do you recover from this?
We talk about it. I talk about it, you know, with guys at the shop all the time. It's not about screwing up. It's about how you handle it.
Yeah.
Right? Everybody's going to screw up.
Yeah.
Did you try to hide it? Did you take care of the customer? Did you do this? Whatever. Like,
did you learn from it?
Yeah.
You're going to do it again.
Exactly. Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, so that's just part of life. If you're trying new things, if you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, which is moving forward and trying new things and getting outside of your comfort zone, there's no way that it's not going to happen. So but if you let it smoke you, then that's that.
Car or law enforcement? Which one's next? What do you want to say for last?
Let's hit law enforcement.
All right.
Because the color one, I still have to keep thinking about it.
All right.
I'll be honest with you.
Your favorite law enforcement interaction story?
Oh, man, I gotta think.
I'm sure the statute of limitations is ran out by now.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm trying to think.
The one it's time in Mexico,
something I sometime I got caught and they
just you, we're everybody's not caught. Everybody's
maybe you saw maybe the lights.
Everybody's had a time where they've interacted with law enforcement. They're like, wow, that one was memorable. Yeah. For good or bad or whatever it is.
Man.
Or maybe you
haven't. I've had several.
I'm trying to think of what is actually the best one. That doesn't make me look too bad.
Yeah, we can bypass this.
No, I have several.
It's like I kicked the ever-living shit out of my wife one night.
And it was probably going to make you look pretty bad.
Yeah.
So that's where we edited it out.
Yeah. I don't have any that are, like, egregious like that.
From a speeding story, got away with something.
Yeah, I gotta trigger the memory speeding story. Nothing too crazy, really. I think when we were street racing, I mean, it was... I had the back seat out of the Chevelle because I was like getting it reupholstered, and I had blown the fuse in the rear taillights, and so they were out. I had no idea, and he pulled me out and had me sitting on the curb and was just, they called him Super Cop out there. He was like the main guy, like in charge of breaking up the street racing, and he was just going like, this is a modification for illegal street racing, and this is a modification for illegal street racing, and you're blah, 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 and I'm just like, no, you don't know. It's like
I screwed up on the taillights.
Yeah, yeah. Like I didn't even know that. Like, but that's a good idea. It's like, so you can run and we can't see your license plate and your taillights. I'm like, no, it's really not. He's like, yeah, tell it to the judge. You know, like I have some like other like stupid ones that just But that one like has always stood out to me. It's like you couldn't be more like far from the truth. I have like no money. Like I'm out here just having fun. Like thanks for letting me know my taillights are out. but this is not a modification. But he's like, I'm gonna tow your car right now. And then he just ended up giving me a fix it ticket and it let me go. I was like, oh sweet, like all right. Like it wasn't that bad. I guess it's not that good of a story, but I just thought it was funny. Like all these quasi modifications for illegal street racing that were not. And I was just hoping that he didn't like ask me to pop the trunk and see the nitrous bottle that was turned on, you know, like stuff like that. It's just like, it was right there, but like didn't see that or didn't even think of that. It's just like, oh yeah. Cause my back seat's out of the car. Like, yeah, it's for street racing. But yeah,
I got pulled over in a Chevelle, the green one.
You got rolled in the thing?
Yeah. And so at the time in Illinois, you can get license plates that were antique vehicle, and you can only drive it to and from shows. So this is a Porsche GT3 RS green 70 Chevelle.
Signal green.
Signal, yeah. Super obnoxiously loud.
Very subtle.
Yeah. Get pulled over, had the insurance and registration in a folder in the trunk, open the trunk, and there's a fuel safe cell in there. Cop goes, whoa, what are you doing? That's nitrous. I'm like, no, it's a gas tank. That's nitrous. Don't tell me what it is. What? It's a gas tank. I open it up. Don't open it. It's going to explode. Like, what? It's a gas tank.
I never heard this.
Yeah. It was right by Jay Alexander's on Lake Hook.
Huh.
So then he looks at the license plate. This is an antique vehicle. You can't be driving it. You're only allowed to go to and from shows. I'm like, well, I got the tickets right here. I'm going to the Good Guy show in Joliet at the time. And he's just giving me a hard time about it. I'm like, I did everything right for once, and you're just rolling me for everything that you think. But yeah, similar situation. Then I got on and did burnouts and fucked around downtown.
And yeah, well, you got your one pullover for the day over with, so you were free to do whatever.
Yeah, didn't do anything wrong, got pulled over for it.
Fuck. Knock on wood, I've never been pulled over in a fast car. It's always
been doing something stupid. Yeah, I just remembered a story. I've never told this story on the thing. So when I moved to Birmingham right out of college, all my friends were still in Atlanta. So every Friday, as soon as I'd get off work at 5:00, I'd already have a bag. I'd leave Birmingham and drive to Atlanta to go hang out with my friends all weekend long. And then I would usually leave about 3:00 in the morning on Sunday or Monday morning. And that would give me enough time to go show back up to work, and I could work Monday, right, and then go home and sleep. So that was my kind of thing. Well, I'm rolling out of Atlanta at about 2:00 in the morning, right, headed to Birmingham. And at that point in time, I had a Civic, right, and I had full tweed interior. The entire, every A-pillar, the entire dash, everything. There wasn't a stitch of color in it. It was all gray tweed. The entire carpet, seats,
it's fucking cool,
everything. No, it wasn't.
Yeah, it sounds awesome.
Right, yes. I'm just giving the story, right, because it means something.
Yeah, I'm with you.
Right, I know. You're rolling super you supportive, here. Right? In the back, in the trunk, I worked at a stereo shop, so it was nothing but amps and subs, right? So I had 6 10s, right, and then a row of amps and things. It was all built in the trunk. So all tweed. So I'm rolling and not speeding, not doing anything, but maybe like 4 or 5 over, right? So get stopped by highway patrol, right? Pulled over on Highway 20, right outside of Atlanta, pulled over. Guy comes up, and he's like, you know, license registration, I see it. And he says, pop out of the car and all that. I said, okay, no problem. And he said, you know how fast you were going? I said, I couldn't have been going that much fast. You know, he's like, well, 4 miles an hour speeding. All right, I apologize. So he's shining his lights, you know, and stuff. And the car's hammered. It's got a wing on it. It's got wheels on it. And late night, okay, no problem. So he starts looking, and he looks in the floorboard, and he picks up a little piece of something, right? And he's like, you know what this is? I'm like, no. He's like, that's weed. Right. And at this point, and I didn't smoke, right? So he's like, this is weed. I said, that's not weed. You're smoking weed. Where is the rest of it at? I don't have any weed. I'm like, well, I'm searching. All right, no problem. So he's in the car, all that stuff. He pops the trunk and he sees all the subs and he's like, that's where the weed's at. I'm like, it's not in my subs. And I'm being new, super nice, right? I've had significant law enforcement interaction at this point in time. So, and I said, no, I promise, you know, I take everything apart and all that kind of stuff. He goes to the thing and he gets a fucking cordless drill and he's he unscrews and pulling the subs out of the boxes, right?
How did he have a cordless drill on?
He's got a cordless drill and a thing. He's got a whole tool bag. He brings the tool bag.
At this era, what did the cordless drill look like? What
are we talking about? Is a Craftsman. Okay. Craftsman black with the big. Yeah. Because this was
like a car battery on the bottom.
Yeah.
So. Plug-in Black and Decker. Yeah. It only goes one way.
So he pops the one sub out, right? And he's shining a light looking down in the thing, right? But then he pops the other sub out and he's looking at the thing. And he's like, how's this amp cover come up? I was like, man, all that stuff's like built in. I promise you, I don't have any. Like, bring a dog out or something. I just don't want to have to put all that shit back together. Like, it's built. And so he gets on the radio, right? Makes me wait. I'm sitting there on the side of the road and I'm tired already. He comes back and he's like, all right, I'm going to let you go this time. I'm sure there's weed in there somewhere, but I don't have time to find it. And he just leaves, right? Yeah. Takes his tools, takes everything. I got subs sitting on the ground. I'm like, I got to drive 2.5 hours back and I don't have any fucking stereo, right? So, yeah, that was the story.
You didn't find it. Still had plenty of stereo. No subs.
Well, just those stubs, yeah. Still.
Yeah.
All that, and have to drive back, put it all back together.
That's annoying. That's what they always say. Like, yeah, I'm sure it's in there. I got something to go. You're lucky. Like,
yeah, you're lucky. I'm about to find it.
They can't admit. But, yeah, I've had some good interactions with law enforcement. So, there's always a bad egg everywhere, you know.
Oh, I've had great law enforcement interactions. Yeah, and also horrible ones. But, yeah. All right.
The problem is that they're never asking the right questions. They're looking for the wrong thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The one that I shared, they were looking for weed as well. Little did they know, like, they totally overlooked the fact that we just, like, my buddy, just cut donuts through, like, 75 people's lawns and over.
Yeah, you should ask that.
Like, multiple mailboxes, over recycling bins, over garbage cans. And I went like this with my hands. When they pulled me over, I just, like, put them in my lap. And they yanked me out of the car, thought I was, like, hiding something. I'm like, well, because you didn't have your eye on the prize.
Right. Well, I will say they got a tough fucking job to do.
Yes.
And I'll deal with all of the dumb shit. Well, yeah. I'll deal with all the dumb shit that I've ever been put through for two reasons. Because they got a shitty job to do, and I know how many times I've gotten away with the shit. So if I've gotten away with 50 times, right? There's a time that I know I wasn't doing anything wrong, and I'm like, that's fine. Put me through all the shit you want to put me through because it's way easier than you catching me doing the dumb shit that I was doing.
You get an appreciation for it. I got rolled in my wife's SUV maybe a year and a half ago doing like 25 over. Lady cop, she was super nice. You could tell she was a little bit nervous, probably new. Wrote me a ticket for like 18 over something. I said, you know, I'm flying.
I'm
right?
Speeding.
Like, I get it. Thanks for your service.
Yep.
Appreciate it. No problem. Like,
that one's on me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you guys have off the record out here, like those ticket fighting services?
No.
Like, we have that.
We're like 10% less kinky than California.
Oh, it's so crazy because I've gone and fought tickets by myself and I always lose. Like, you're like, oh, I was in the right. I'm like, and they're like, sir, you have to answer. You have to ask this in the form of a question. You're like, I got to be like a
sorry,
lawyer.
Trebek.
I got to be like a lawyer up here now. Like, and then you stumble. They're like, guilty. You're like,
you fucked me.
But like, I use this. I don't know. It's off the record. You send him a pic. I was caught dead to rights, radar speeding 90 miles an hour during COVID to work. Didn't say anything. Just he goes, oh yeah, you're doing this. Clocked you at this. Here's your ticket. I said, okay, thank you. And took a picture of it, sent it this thing. I got nothing to lose. You know, it's like, I don't want these points on my record. I was about to finish the GTA. I needed all the points I could get. So I didn't need to be losing my license.
Yeah.
I know. You're like, they should almost roll over. You know, like if it's not just you get 8 and your license is gone. No, I haven't had any tickets in like 2 decades. I should have like 50. You know?
Rollover minutes.
Yeah. So I just did that. And you take a picture of it. They assign a lawyer to it. And then they ended up pushing that ticket off for 2 years, and then we're just like, yeah, we went to your court date, like, happy to let you know it's dismissed. I'm like, cool, like, that cost me less than traffic school. And then I got a cell phone, like, it was on my cell phone, like a dumbass. Cop rolled right up next to me, he's like, pull over. I'm like, okay. He's like, a cell phone ticket. Did the same thing, got dismissed. One of our drivers was maybe speeding and in one of the heat wave trucks, and that highway patrol gave him a ton of tickets, told him to, I said, here's what I use, try it out. all his stuff got dismissed. Another employee, motorcycle ticket going over 100 got dismissed. So I don't know what they're doing, but
we should start that business here.
It really works.
I got a warning recently, talking on your phone, right? I had it on my ear.
Yeah. And that's illegal.
Yeah. There. It's illegal, obviously. Yeah. So the guy just, he fucking rolls up next to me and gives me the
hang up and drive.
So I pull over and he's like busting my fucking balls about it. And I'm like, dude, I'm like, honestly, I didn't know. I'm fucking on the phone. I didn't know.
Stupidity is like, no excuse.
Right. He's like, it's been a rule for a long time. I'm like, I didn't know. So he's like, I'm going to check your record and we'll see about that. I'm like, okay.
The rap sheet comes up.
Yeah. Well, I've never been pulled over for it. I'm right. Like, dude, now like 90% of the cars have a fucking iPod or iPad in the fucking dashboard.
Right.
Like,
you can play with that, but you can't play with your phone.
Like, I have my phone at my ear. I drive with one hand regardless. What is the danger of that? You know?
It's because like, someone ruined it for everybody.
Like, texting or fucking with my dashboard or something, but God forbid.
No, it's a visual thing that you're able, just like wearing a seatbelt. They can see that you're not wearing a seatbelt, so they can give you a ticket for it. They can see that you're on your phone, so they can give you a ticket for it. They can't ticket you for driving around talking just like you would be holding the phone to the thing.
Yeah, that's stupid. That's just a moneymaker.
Well, it's revenue.
It's easy.
Pay for the.
You know, it's like, I saw you doing that. That's that. It's like, it's just one of those things. It's easy for them, and they're.
You're like, dude, you just touched.
It's a business. You got to pay the piper sometimes.
You just touched like 17 pieces of technology and endangered way more drivers than I did to pull me over.
It's a tax, man.
On their laptop and stuff like that. Yeah, it is just like
pay the bridge tax. But there, you got caught.
But now there's a way out of it with this off the record.
Off the record.
Yeah, it actually works in California.
So. They always check and see if there's like a way to make revenue. They always figure it out. Like, and they don't give a fuck about like safety or what's going on. It's
careful. Careful.
It's the reality of it.
Yeah. Last up.
First car.
First car. All right. We got a couple of questions. Your first car was a gift or did you buy it?
My dad let me use it.
Oh, very key piece.
Well, I guess it was, this is your first car, but then once I destroyed it, he was pissed that I destroyed his car.
I've got.
Okay. And this was, you received this at 16?
I was probably, I think I didn't get my license until I was 18.
Really?
Yeah.
Why is that a California thing?
No, I think I had so many friends that drove. Blading
too much, man.
Yeah. No, I wasn't skating. I was riding moto at that point. My buddy had a truck, and we didn't even go anywhere. We just rode our dirt bikes, and and that was that. I did.
Were you a Honda guy back then?
A Honda dirt bike guy.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
A Honda guy forever.
It was like, all right. When they came out with that aluminum fucking frame.
Yes, in 2001. Yeah, I went from the 95 CR125 to the 2001, and that was like the GT3 RS, like theory, like this 95 one. I was like trying to modify it forever and to get it to be what I wanted, and then got that 2001 and didn't touch it. And that's when I knew it was perfect. Like it was so sick. Yeah,
the thing was cutting edge. Dude had the one just before it. Remember?
Yeah. It'd be, it was probably 98.
Yeah, those aluminum frames were something special. Yeah, it was. Like those
livery on the plastic, everything about it was just
it was a great. Yeah, the 1-800 collect, or they had the 1-800 collect, like the black and red Honda stuff.
Yeah.
That shit was so sick. So
all right, so gift, your dad gifted it to you. This was at 18, so this was going to be what, 2002, 2003?
No, because I graduated in 01, so it had to be 2000, or I think I would have turned 18 and 2000, right? Something like that.
I'm a fire away. I've got something. You're complex because you're very into cars. Your dad was a unique kind of guy.
Yeah.
I could be off base here, but I'm just going to go with my gut. And I think I'm going to hit it with a silver Ford Taurus SHO. it's high performance, right? Huh? He's got, there's a little resentment left about the Fords. Never went back to the Ford. It was kind of just like, been there, done that. RoboCop has, there's some sort of a, you know, likability there. Some, that's just where I'm at.
There's a lot of thought into that. You've realized I don't have any Fords. Like,
yeah. I mean, I didn't just throw that out there out of nowhere. Right.
Yeah.
This is a Cadillac.
Really?
Yeah. It's a Cadillac.
You think dad had a
Cadillac Catera?
No,
close, but no, or older than that. But it's the what is that? The 2600 engine. What's the GM platform? That's the little 4-door Cadillac that was the same. They did the Buick, they did the Oldsmobile, they did all of those in that little smaller compact front wheel drive.
That was 4-door. The Catera, I think.
No, before the Catera, way before the Catera. Or
Cialis.
That's a pill.
No, it was
Cadillac. That smaller platform, boxy Cadillac.
If you can't name it, you can't pick it. I think you should. I think you need to pivot on that.
Caliente. What was it? Caliente. Caliente.
I think you need to pivot. Be honest with you.
I'm just going with square Cadillac, box Cadillac. That makes you fucking happy.
Pretty vague. What do you guys think?
I wanted to go Ford Ranger Splash.
You gotta think he had his other friend. They were all into dirt bikes. His other friends were facilitating the dirt bike situation.
Yeah,
so you got to go 4-wheel drive. Your dad was into skiing, doing ski wax.
Oh, Grand Wagon, Cherokee.
I'm Cherokee Jeep. Something in the Jeep family.
Oh, just the original Cherokee.
A square
Cherokee.
Yeah, Cherokee.
Navy blue.
Good.
A Jim Rosenfeld square Cherokee.
Navy blue.
Good fucking pull. Specific.
Yeah, we do get very specific. We swing and miss a lot, but we get very specific.
Every once in a while, you hit it out of the park.
Even if you lose, the description wins. So.
All right, so it's time to reveal.
Yeah.
I believe it's a 76 Chevy Love.
Oh.
Nobody can guess that.
A Love?
Yeah.
And you wrecked it?
I just hammered it so hard, like, freaking, I think we knocked the distributor cap off. It hit the fan, got shredded into a million pieces.
Were you jumping it?
Yeah. 100%. Like, duct taped it back together, somehow got the firing order, like, three-quarters of the way right. Like, it drove it home, like, and it just never ran the same after that.
Yeah, because you jumped it.
Yeah, no, we jumped it. We were doing J-turns with it, like, down, like, small alleyways. We
Sounds
were
like LeBaron days.
Hitting garbage cans, like, and we would bring it to my friend's house, which is, like, a nice neighborhood, and this is, like, after school, like, 2-3 o'clock, we'd hit all his neighbor's garbage cans, 25 garbage cans, park it back in front of his house. Like, another friend would hop in, go hit the garbage cans again. Yeah. Like, nobody was home. No one was calling the police. Like, there was no surveillance. Like, I know how shitty it is now. I mean, they were just garbage cans, but it was...
Nobody fucks with garbage cans anymore. No. That's all we did as kids. Wait,
garbage can now is like a thing you put your trash in.
I know.
Right? And a mailbox. A mailbox, it's like, that's where they put your mail.
Yeah. A garbage can back in the day, we would spend all weekend... We would talk about it's garbage can weekend. Like, it's nothing but garbage cans all weekend long.
Yeah, Pick them up and throw them at the mailbox.
You knew the different neighborhoods. You're like, oh, no, dude, we're not going down. They're Thursday night.
Yeah,
like, you go down like a quarter mile Northfield, North Trail. That's fucking Friday night. We're going to fuck some garbage cans up.
Yeah. That's what you do. You go out. We didn't drink or really anything then. So it's just like, go out and just, you're 17, 18 years old. It's like, let's go be goons, you know, like, and I'm so glad we didn't have social media then. Like, I would probably still be in jail.
Oh, none of us would be around.
I would just be career, you know, I would have probably got wrapped up by the system, ended up being made into like someone, a torpedo in prison to like go stab someone, and just got myself like another 25 in the system for hitting a garbage can, you know, and posting about it on Instagram. But like, yeah, that was
you were really chasing at that group of like 3 or 4 guys, right? As the loud noise and seeing something like rocket ship launch, and then the oh shit, and getting out of Dodge. That's all the, and then it was like, oh shit, we got away. Now do it again.
Yeah.
And it was the, oh man, boom, get out of here, and then laughing so hard.
Do you remember just organically like witnessing a buddy, like a distant buddy, hit one? Like you're out, you're just out and about for the night.
No, I've never
just,
seen
oh,
that.
Oh yeah, you're out and about for the night, and you're not even planning it because you don't know that that's him. And like you just see an oncoming car, and like you see that thing veer off and
Seen it organically.
Like, dude, that was Keith fucking Krasny. That was like Krasny just railed a fucking garbage can.
Yeah. And if you did that now with it, like a new car, like all your airbags and everything, oh, would go off,
it disable, like, yeah, side like, curtains.
I swear, I had these old Volvos and stuff. We would just hit stuff nonstop with, and it would get out and it'd be fine. Like, I got another one, and I hit stuff with it. Like, bent the pitman arm back. The steering never worked the same since. I was just like, how are these old ones so durable? And like,
dude, the Volvos were rad. My Fenn had the, we called it the Volvo Beast. And it was this was pre-cameras, right? So you just had to witness it with your own eyes.
Yeah.
And I loved to see it. So I would get out, and I'd be like, dude, he would come.
Real life entertainment.
He would come like fishtailing. He'd just whip it around a corner. And I knew he had zero driving skills. So it would always over-rotate, and then he would over-correct. So I would entice him to, like, do this, right? And, like, on side roads, residential roads, I'd get out, and I'd be like, dude, fucking, you know. Hang it out,
but snap.
Hang it out. It would be. He would chase it like 6 times back and forth, and always it would loop out and end up in somebody's lawn. You know, and then you'd go running. And like,
yeah, I mean, you did the same thing. I got my buddy do that. He like hit a curb, like broke his wheel, like. Yeah. Bent everything. I'm just sitting there like dying laughing. It's like, oh, you got to go home and tell your mom that I'm out of here.
But we were staying out of trouble, so to speak.
Yeah, we didn't do anything real bad.
Yeah, yeah, nothing real bad. And I didn't like hurt anybody or anything like that. Yeah, like some property damage, you know, like.
Right. Nothing a little sod couldn't take care of.
Yeah.
And nothing little homeowners insurance wouldn't take care of.
Yeah, yeah.
It was innocent back then.
Yeah. I think that's like another thing with the skating, not to go all the way back to the beginning, but you're like now like in your 30s and 40s, like damaging like public and private property, waxing ledges and sliding handrails and stuff. And you're like, and these people are like coming out yelling at you, like security guards are like half your age. You're like, I'm too old to be doing.
Yeah.
Like as now as like a property owner, I was like, yeah, I'd be kind of pissed if someone came and waxed my curb I spent.
We
like
talk about that all the time. Yeah. Imagine somebody coming and giving you a lawn job at your home that you own right now.
What the fuck?
You were like, that's.
I don't know what I would do. I don't know what I would do.
I'd move. I'd move.
I would either move.
You could sand it; it'll still be there.
Or it would become a permanent feature of the lawn. I would just like. You know, plant flowers or something.
There you go. Yeah.
Just the act of replacing a mailbox.
Oh, it's a major deal.
I don't have time for that.
The fucking snowplow. Well, it happened to you. It happened to me. The fucking snowplow dude just hit it. And I'm like, fuck. And what's hard to find, like, I'm not digging a hole and putting cement in and going to, like, put a post in. It's hard to find just the thing that you just hammer in the ground, like the stake.
Yes.
Hawthorne Woods came and did mine.
Yeah, not me.
Yeah.
I had to do mine myself.
Well, I live in a little
but that
bit
was an
different
that
area.
Was an ordeal, right?
Yeah, we took
it's a horrible.
If I had to cement that thing, Jesus.
We took out the neighbor's mailbox at the shop twice now. I hit it once with one of the Heatwave RC cars. I like flipped it. It was a 4x4 post. It flipped up, hit the mailbox off, and like still somehow broke the post. But yeah, I had to go to Home Depot, like, because it was like a 4x4 and like a 2x4, and it was like all like miter cut to like work, and so he had to like custom make it and okay put it back. And then after like a company event, one of the kids like was leaving hot and he hit it again. It was like it's almost like the lawn ornament in Home Alone, how it just keeps getting smacked. And it's just like I have to hit him up. I'm like, hey, we hit your mailbox again, like sorry. It's like kind of like,
how about we just move your mailbox because it's in a bad spot.
You know, I was just like, I'm so sorry, you probably think we're the worst neighbors ever, but like we'll fix it. And it's something as simple as a mailbox. I swear it takes like 6 to 8 hours the next day and like 3 Home Depot
it's a $1,500 fucking fix.
When I feel in the 90s, like the early to mid 90s, it was a full-blown pandemic. Like mailboxes being destroyed was a fucking pandemic. We used to have them in our neighborhood. You remember that had the giant bell on the back of them?
Yeah.
There were two of them in our
neighborhood. Remember the Rubbermaid ones?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, those you couldn't
crank.
Remember the ones on a spring?
It would fight back. Yeah, people were like, they were
resilient.
There
was a thing where you take the Rubbermaid ones, you drill a hole and fill them with concrete. So when you whack it with a baseball.
Yeah, you're
fucked up.
Remember the ones on the coil spring at the bottom?
Yes.
Remember the ones that are on the spring?
Yeah.
We were getting those big electrical, like spool of wires, the wooden spools that are like a pallet, but for a spool. And we just thought it was the best idea to roll them down these hills. And so didn't think anything. I was like, oh, there could be oncoming cars. There could be people walking. And one time it just took out a row of like 15 garbage cans. I was like, that was awesome. It went like down this curved hill and bounced off. They're like, we didn't think it could go through someone's front door. And then another time it like went around this, it hit this like curb, bounced up, and then like took out like six mailboxes. We're like, oh, shit. Yes. And then another time we were rolled it down a hill, and then like some bicyclist was biking up the hill and had to get out of the way. And we're like, oh, we could kill someone like this. Like, we need to stop now. It's like those things, like, you're like, you almost have to experience it and do it and not get in trouble to then like, and see where your moral compass is. Like, and then you're like, oh, this is stupid. Like, you have to stop that. Like,
it takes a while to grow up.
We all found like the boundaries right on our own. Like, you pushed it like just close enough. And then you're like, oh, that's,
we did. Yes. Me and Corey would always run around, and Jeff Todd was our other buddy. Right. So Jeff Todd's, he was 2 years older than us, and he was working. We were seniors, and he was working full-time,
what
right?
What kind of cigarettes did he smoke?
And, Jeff Todd didn't smoke no cigarettes. Yeah, he had bitch tits and didn't smoke. And his parents were, like, 96 years old, and he was, like, 20, right?
Okay.
And he lived at this perfect location right off this main road that was at the crest of a hill, right? And it was dark, no lights. So me and Corey would be out, right? Jeff never came with us, right? But we would always go crash at Jeff's house, right? We were out, and it would always be the same thing. You know, whatever, we'd take girlfriends home, we'd do whatever it was. Start getting late in the night, we're like, hey, you want to go block traffic at Jeff's house, right? And it was just the thing, every Friday and Saturday night. So you'd go to Jeff's house, and he had a carport, no garage, right? And they had, like, the big, you know, green plastic trash can, like two of them, and then a recycling thing. And it was always, we'd pull in. We wouldn't even tell Jeff we were there. He would hear us pull up. But we would just pull up, shut the lights off. There's no lights on in the carport because it's late. There's no street lights. And we would roll the three trash cans out in the middle of the road, right? But it was at the crest of a hill. And you can't see either way until it's too late. And we would just sit there in the carport and just wait. And we would do this. I mean, we did it for probably 3 years, every Friday and Saturday night, just about. And you sit there, and it was the same sound. You could hear, you could hear the car coming, right? And it was always the car would get, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. The car gets louder, and then you hear the, and it was just enough to just hit the thing. And you would get about four hits in before Jeff's dad would wake up and start screaming and hollering, and we'd have to leave, right? And Jeff's like, hey, fucking. But you would think people would start saying, hey, Friday and Saturday nights, there's trash cans blocking that road. But it's just something as stupid as that. Nobody ever hit it hard, but it was enough to, like, and we never did drugs, like, or doing some of the stupid shit. We just blocked the
road. At least not while doing that.
Not while doing that.
But then you, like, hear the horror stories of people doing that stuff, and someone, like, veers off or crashes and gets hurt. And you're like, oh, like, that can happen. You're like, or, like, people taking stop signs and stuff because they want to hang it in their room, and someone getting in a huge wreck.
Because no stop sign.
Yeah. I mean, there's just, we just heard about tons of stuff like that, you know? And you know, we grew up when there was like, what's that movie, The Good Son, when he's throwing like dummies on the bridges and
Highwayman?
Stuff.
Highwayman? Yeah. Yeah, they fucking made Highwayman.
Yeah.
It's fucking threw that dude that, like,
So there's tons of stuff like that. But yeah, like, you either continue going and you become a worse person, or you're like, oh, but that's like part of the adolescence. And like, I don't know if you can, if that's even out there anymore. I mean, there's some element, but I feel like there's a whole lot of, you can't do that now without the risk of possibly ruining your life forever.
Yeah.
With social media now.
The social media part, definitely. It's changed things. Yeah.
But then you have people doing stuff like, for like pranks and dumb stuff, just for a rise out of people,
just
which is
get
just to grind, on people. And that's like equally as shitty or a different type of shitty. I don't know. We're always going to kind of look back and say it used to be better, but I think that every generation has been like that.
Yeah. That's how you know you're getting older.
Yeah.
When you're like, oh, these kids didn't do it like we did.
Yeah. He's doing it different.
Justin, it's been fucking awesome. What's next for Heatwave?
Just stay the course. Got some cool new innovative products coming out. Just going to keep doing the same stuff in media, keep making cool products, and yeah, just stay at it. You know, like the gas tank's still full. We still got fire to burn, you know? So that's just the general gist of it right now, you know, just keep the passion alive, try and just continue to elevate it, because that's what keeps it fun for us. I always tell the guys, like, feels like we're always like somehow we're always busier, and but like look back like 2 years and stuff, it's like, would the, what we're doing right now even be possible 2 years ago? It's like, no. It's like, because I've been in this business that's been declining before, and that was with the skate shop. That's what I got jaded. I was like, I got to do something new, because we had done stuff to a certain level, and our budget basically, I mean, I had to reduce the budget. It was the first time I ever had to lay off people. Like, had to, couldn't do this, these custom apparel pieces anymore. Couldn't do this liner brand anymore, because their market just wasn't there. So like, as long as we can incrementally just continue to raise the bar for us each year and keep things interesting, kind of like what you guys do with the cars and stuff. It's like, went from this thing where things were almost two-dimensional to this 3D-dimensional CNC machine grills and things where it's at now, you know, like, I mean, it, for us, it's just like that. It's like, okay, we got these little ideas, and now it's like, we got, we can throw them into the, you know, listen to the customer and keep releasing products that get people excited. Because at the end of the day, we are a product-based company. It's like, it is like a very fun brand to be a part of, but like, we do have to sell product. People do have to be into the product for it to be viable for everybody. So yeah, it's just this, just keep leveling up every year. Just going to keep going with that. And hopefully people are still into the brand. Because, you know, it's like, we're in this stage where it's like, I think the first 5 years are extremely difficult, and then you have like the next 5 to 10 where it's like people are still learning about you. It's like this new brand, like it's the new cool brand. Like, it's okay to have little like shortcomings, but it's like, ah, oh, you're new and cool, you know, like, but then at like the 10-year mark and 15-year mark, there's no excuses for having like shit.
You got to get your shit together now.
Yeah, it's right. Like people, more is expected from you, so you can't slide. You can't release stuff that was on par with this old stuff. You can't go, oh, we're learning. Like, no, you got to have your shit together. So like, me as like a product developer and production manager and stuff like that, like, we've learned a lot. We're with a lot of good partners and things like that. So it's like, okay, taking our expertise and just continuing to level it up and in every way, shape, and form, whether it's better fulfillment, better product design, better marketing, better whatever, you know, everything, better events. Like, now with the event crews, we're able to do more events. Like, now, how do we just continue to do more of what we're doing to continue to elevate the brand at every level? And just so people see it and be like, oh yeah, it's not, I know, like, they're, what they make is super cool, and I know someone there, I know those guys, or see what they're doing, and they're doing cool stuff, and I can relate to them. You know, it's not like, oh, it turned into this brand where it's like, yeah, I have no idea what they're doing anymore. They used to be cool, or they were cool that, you know, 10 years ago. So I think now making it this brand that lasts the test of time is the next biggest challenge, and is the hardest challenge of them all.
Yeah.
Because, you know,
for sure.
But that's the long-winded answer of what's next. It's all next.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Dude, I'm a huge fan, dude. Love the fucking brand. Like, looking forward to following what you guys do. Looking forward to fucking continuing to be a customer, man. It's badass. Everything you guys do kicks ass. Great having you on here, dude.
Thank you.
Not that you need it, but nothing but the best of luck. We love the brand. Echo everything that Jeremy's saying. And honestly, if you're listening to this, if you want to be fucking cool, like, we've just explained to you for the last 3 fucking hours why Heatwave's fucking cool.
Yeah.
So if you don't have a pair, then you're not fucking cool.
Be cool.
You going to y'all going to SEMA?
I've actually never been to SEMA.
You going this year?
I'm not.
You
want to go? I'm no. My daughter is now born like on SEMA. Her birthday is on SEMA, so we don't
bring her with.
She's got a huge party plan. My lady plans a good birthday party for her.
I get it.
Like,
it's
more important.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So like, it's always
you got your priorities.
It's always been the running joke, because this Chevelle was supposed to go to SEMA like 18 times already. Yeah. You know, like, oh, it's gonna be done by SEMA. Like, buy your tickets, like, or get your plane tickets. I'm like, okay, yeah. And so it's like,
well,
yeah.
SEMA's a whole week. Her birthday party doesn't run a whole week, right? Oh, you're close.
It's a 5-year-old.
Okay, so it's a whole thing.
She already thinks, she's like, oh, when's my birthday? 20 days. They're like, oh, you know, like, already, like, she's been birthday shopping for a while, you know. So, and my lady does like the balloon arches and all the,
you know, I got you,
all the decor, like the.
It's a thing.
It takes a week to set it up, and then I spend a whole day popping balloons and tearing stuff down. I'm like, oh my god, but yeah. It's so I'm like, and I get to see. That's the nice thing about social media. It's like, I get to see all the best stuff on there, like, and all the Bluetooth drive shafts, all that stuff gets posted right away. It's like, I don't have to go anymore. I have to walk 75 miles. Like, all the coolest shit gets brought to the forefront of the feed, and I get to zoom in, and there we go.
Well, hope to see you again soon. It's been absolute fucking blast. Love getting to know you. Love getting to hear more about Heatwave.
Thank you.
So you got like fucking 50 social medias. You got Heatwave Racing, you got Heatwave Visual, and then yours is at Ace Sanders.
Yeah, Ace Sanders.
Check it out. See you again next week.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, thank you.